When All is Found. Chapter 1. Prince Arron. As the great ship sailed through the exceptionally blue water early in the morning, 16-year-old Princess Erica stood at the railing and let the wind whip through her long black hair. She had always loved being at sea for as long as she could remember, and today was no exception. The smell of the ocean surrounded her like an old friend. Dolphins raced alongside the ship below as if they could sense Erica's excitement. Her sheepdog, Maxine, eagerly barked and pranced around her legs, seemingly feeding off of her joy.
Isn't this great? The salty sea air, the wind blowing in your face. The perfect day to be at sea.
Erica's personal attendant, Grimhilda, slowly leaned up from the railing, her face a very ugly shade of green.
Oh, yes. Delightful. Oh.
The poor woman leaned over the ship again to retch. Erica smiled sympathetically for her lady's maid, who had been her attendant for nearly 10 years now. They'd been through thick and thin together and knew more about one another than was probably traditionally appropriate. One fact Erica knew all too well about Grimhilda was that she got seasick very easily, which was quite unfortunate, seeing as a princess spent more time on ships than she did on land. One of the sailors tied down the mainsail.
A fine strong wind and a following sea. King Triton must be in a friendly type mood.
King Triton?
Why, ruler of the mer people, lass. Thought every good sailor knew about him and his wife, the Queen Athena.
Erica smiled at being recognized as a good sailor among the other men, even if she was a young princess. She playfully glared at Grimhilda, who was beginning to somewhat gain her sea legs.
I am afraid the study of ocean life was frowned upon in the palace.
And for good reason. A princess has no need to pay any attention to this nautical nonsense.
But it ain't nonsense. It's the truth. I'm telling you, down in the depths of the ocean they live.
Of course, no one knew just how right the old man was. For many fathoms below the sailing ship and just a few nautical miles away, the 18-year-old merprince of the underwater city of Atlantica, Arron, eagerly swam through the water until he finally arrived at the site of a very old sunken ship resting forgotten on the ocean floor.
Arron, wait for me!
Arron turned to look at his closest friend and companion swimming up behind him.
Angel, hurry up!
You know I can't swim that fast!
The yellow and blue striped fish panted. Arron looked out at the wrecked ship.
Isn't this amazing?
Yeah, sure. It's great. Now let's get out of here.
Oh no, we didn't swim all this way just to look at it. Come on.
But Arron, it looks damp in there, and I think I may be coming down with something. See? Let's just go home.
Look, if you really don't want to go inside, you don't have to.
Really?
Yeah, you can just stay here and keep watch, okay? I shouldn't be too long.
Okay. I can do that. Keep watch for what?
For sharks.
Arron swam inside one of the portholes on the side of the ship.
Okay. Wait, what? Sharks? Arron!
Petrified at the idea of such a large predator in the area, Angel quickly tried to swim through the porthole. But to her embarrassment, it was too small for her.
Arron, help!
Arron laughed kindly and swam over to the porthole. He grasped Angel's fins and gently eased his friend through the small opening.
Arron, do you really think there might be sharks around here?
Angel, don't be such a guppy.
I'm not a guppy.
The two of them swam deeper through the lower decks of the ship. Arron's vibrant red hair, green tail, and the orange bag he always brought with him on his excavations stood out even brighter than usual amongst their dilapidated surroundings. His eyes filled with glimmering excitement as he looked around and tried to find something that he could add to his collection. Angel nervously eyed the ship's crumbling rooms, half expecting to see a shark hiding in the remains.
This is great!
Maybe if she talked aloud about how much fun this adventure was, she would actually convince herself of it.
I mean, I really love this. Excitement, adventure, danger lurking around every...
Her pep talk was cut off when she came face to face with a skeleton propped up along one of the ship's walls. Angel screamed in fear and swam backwards right into one of the weakened wooden posts. Part of the decayed deck above them caved in, and Angel jetted forward into Arron's arms.
It's okay. Nothing here is gonna hurt us.
Right! Right, of course!
Angel said, her entire body quivering. Arron looked up at the hole that had formed in the upper deck above them when the post had fallen, and swam up to peek out of it.
Whoa, look!
He excitedly swam over to a strange, small tool with three prongs and picked it up.
Isn't this incredible?
Wow, cool! What is it?
I don't know, but I bet Scuttle will.
He shoved the tool into the small orange bag. Then he swam over to another peculiarly shaped object, oblivious to Angel's concerns that something was outside the ship.
I wonder what this one is.
Arron!
Angel, relax. We're all alone out here.
Angel looked through the large window behind her and found herself staring right into a large, open mouth.
I don't think so! Shark!
Arron quickly turned around as the window in the ship smashed to pieces, and a huge shark burst inside. He and Angel frantically swam out of the room and back the way they'd come in, Angel screaming in panicked fear all along the way. Suddenly, the shark burst out of the floor beneath them, its hundreds of teeth prepared to rip them to shreds, and its eyes glaring at them hungrily. The two of them doubled back and raced to the porthole. Angel once again became stuck when she tried to swim out of it, but Arron quickly pushed her out and then swam out himself. The shark smashed straight through the side of the ship and continued to chase after them. Just when it seemed they might be able to escape, Angel accidentally swam directly into the top pole of the mast. Dazed, she began to sink down to the ocean floor. Arron looked back in horror at Angel's limp form that the shark had also gotten eyes on. He quickly swam over to his friend and reached through a hole in an anchor to catch her. The shark angrily swam directly towards them, but it was so greedy and eager to feed that it didn't pay attention to where it was going and swam directly into the hole in the anchor, where it lodged firmly and couldn't escape. Now safe from the shark's wrath, Arron and Angel quickly swam away from the shipwreck.
See? I told you nothing was going to happen to us.
Angel glared at him.
Sorry.
After their brush with death, Arron and Angel swam up to the surface of the ocean. Mermaids and mermen could only be out of the water for a couple hours or so before their bodies required them to go back under the sea, and trips to the surface had been outlawed several years ago. But Arron had no choice to go above the water if he wanted to find out more about all of the treasures he collected. And the one who explained each object and its use to him was a female seagull he had recently become acquainted with. She was a self-proclaimed expert about all things human-related. Arron surfaced next to a small piece of rock, somewhat close to land, but far enough away that there was no danger of a human accidentally spotting him.
Good morning, Scuttle.
The seagull looked up from her perch on what used to be a crow's nest.
Arron?
Down here.
Scuttle looked down at the ocean.
Oh, hiya, sweetie. Bring anything else for me to look at?
Of course.
He pulled his bag out of the water and set it onto the rock.
Right, let's take a look-see here.
Scuttle very ungracefully fell off the crow's nest and onto the hard rock below it, then quickly picked herself up and began digging through Arron's bag.
What do we have here?
She said as she pulled out the three-prong tool.
Wow, this is special. This is very unusual.
What is it?
It's a dinglehopper. Humans use these little babies to straighten their hair out. You should see what kind of hairstyle some of these women are walking around with.
She stuck the dinglehopper into the feathers on her head and twirled it around.
See, just a little twirl here and a little yank there and...
She pulled the tool out of the feathers, which all bunched up around her head, while a couple of them fell out.
There you have it! An aesthetically pleasing configuration of hair that humans go nuts over.
Arron picked up the tool.
A dinglehopper, huh?
He pulled the other object out of his bag.
What about this?
Oh, my goodness, I haven't seen this in years. A banded, bulbous snarfblat.
What does a snarfblat do?
Well, dear, it all goes back to prehistorical times when humans used to sit around and stare at each other all day. As you can imagine, it was very boring. So they invented the snarfblat to make fine music. Here, allow me.
Unfortunately, when Scuttle blew into the object, which was actually a smoking pipe, years' worth of seaweed and ocean muck burst out of it instead of the music they'd been expecting.
Music? The competition. Oh, Mom is going to kill me!
You mean the singing competition? That was today?
Arron frantically shoved everything back into his bag.
The last time Mom was mad at me, she caused a hurricane. On land and in the water. Oh, we've got to get home now. Bye, Scuttle.
Oh, bye, sweetie. See you next time.
Hopefully there is a next time.
Arron thought as he raced back home as fast as his fins would take him. As soon as he entered the city gates, two merman soldiers stopped him.
We are to take you to your mother, your highness. She insisted that you see her the second you return.
This was going to be very unpleasant. Of all the days to forget something. The soldiers escorted him to the throne room, where he found his mother, the queen, sitting atop her throne with her trident in hand. She was currently giving him an especially frightful glare that made Arron wish he was back battling the shark, because that was preferable to being in this room right now. The two soldiers swam away, which left Arron the sole recipient of his mother's glare. Queen Athena was a beautiful mermaid. In her youth, she had had hair the same vibrant red as Aaron's, but age and stress had since turned it a silvery color. Not only was she a queen of the entire kingdom of Atlantica, she was also a single mother to 7 boys, which would test even the most saintly woman's patience. She could be very loving and tender when she needed to be, but she could also be so strict and temperamental that one would beg for her mercy in hope she didn't use her trident on him. Unfortunately for Arron, this moment was one of the latter.
Mother?
Save it, Arron. I don't want to hear any more of your excuses. As a result of your careless behavior, the competition was a disaster.
Does it really matter that much that we win?
That's not the point. You made a commitment to be there. Many of the merpeople in attendance were only there to watch you compete.
It's a pointless competition anyway.
It's tradition. The annual singing competition is something that the people of Atlantica have looked forward to since before you were born. Everyone knows that you've developed a beautiful voice as you've aged, and they were looking forward to finally having the chance to watch you show your skills.
A very small red crab, the queen's advisor, Serena, skittered onto the armrest of the throne.
I have worked for years to coach you and improve your singing abilities. And I spent the last 4 years alone composing songs for you and your brothers to sing at this competition. And you couldn't even bother to show up?
I'm sorry.
What was so important that you completely forgot about the commitment that you made and were willing to let everyone down?
Arron's stomach fluttered as he tried to think of an answer that wouldn't get him in even more trouble. Angel quickly swam up next to him.
It wasn't Arron's fault!
She insisted, shrinking a little under the queen's hard look.
Well, first the shark chased us.
A shark?
Arron smiled a little, thinking that maybe Angel might actually help him get a little sympathy.
Yeah, and we tried to, but we couldn't, and, and then we were safe. But then the seagull came, and it was, this is this, and that is that, and...
Wait a minute, a seagull?
Angel gasped when she realized her slip and swam behind Aaron's shoulder. Arron took it back.
You're telling me you missed one of our most important traditions because you went up to the surface again? Well, at least it was a good reason.
Nothing happened, Mother. I was careful.
Arron, how many times do I have to tell you? What if you'd been seen? What if you'd been captured? Those horrible barbarians will not hesitate to capture a mermaid or merman if they ever see one. Are you trying to be one of those poor souls?
They're humans, not barbarians.
What's the difference? You haven't seen the cruelty they'll inflict on any creature of the sea like I have. Do you think I want to see my youngest son snared by some savage's hook?
Mom, I'm not a child anymore!
Well, you're certainly acting like one. Missing important engagements, slacking off on your royal duties, breaking our laws. What am I supposed to think about all of that?
It's not that simple. If you would just listen for once.
Start showing some respect around here, and maybe I will. This conversation is over. You will apologize to your brothers for missing the competition, and you will be taking over Avery's duties tomorrow.
What? But his job is the dullest one out of all of them.
Then maybe that will teach you how to stay focused on what's important. And I am never to hear about you going to the surface ever again. Do you understand me?
Mother!
I said, do you understand me?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes, Your Majesty.
Good. You're dismissed.
With a frustrated sigh, Arron swam out of the throne room.
Sorry, Arron. I didn't mean to.
I know. But maybe don't try to help me next time.
The Merprince grimaced as he returned to the room he shared with his six older brothers. Being the youngest of them meant that Arron was on the receiving end of a lot of taunts, teases, and abuse. But then, at the end of the day, he knew that he would die for any one of them, and he was sure that they felt the same. Though the cold temperature of the water in the room told him that that might not be the case at the current time.
Look who finally decided to join us.
Adonis, the eldest prince, said as he crossed his arms.
You're about 5 hours late.
I'm sorry. I lost track of time.
Arden, his second oldest brother, slung an arm around Aaron's shoulders.
Lost track of time. On today, of all days. I hope whatever you were doing instead was worth it.
As much as Arron treasured his new prizes, he wasn't sure it was worth all of this trouble. If only he'd waited just one more day, he could have avoided all this and his mother probably wouldn't have found out about his little trip to see Scuttle. Avery, the prince closest to Arron in age, lay on his bed of kelp with his arms crossed behind his head.
Come on, guys, lay off. It's not his fault he gets distracted so easily.
The next oldest, Atticus, glared at Avery.
Easy for you to say. You get to have the day off tomorrow because he screwed up.
Come on, you guys couldn't have sounded that bad.
The third oldest, Apollo, swam up to him.
Obviously, we sounded amazing. But, as you are well aware, there were a few parts of the song that required a seventh male voice, which we were lacking. You cost us the competition.
What's the big deal about the whole thing anyway? It's a stupid tradition. Who cares about how well mermaids and mermen sing?
The fourth in line, Asa, gently put a hand on Aaron's shoulder.
It's something that brings everyone together. Each of us have different talents and strengths. But singing is the one thing we all have in common.
Arron sighed as he faced all of his brothers.
I really am sorry about missing it. I know how much it meant to you guys and how hard you've worked on your performance.
Adonis turned away from him.
Hard work all for nothing, thanks to you.
He said he was sorry.
Sorry isn't going to bring back all of the time we spent rehearsing for today or win us the competition. How does it make our mother the queen look if her own son doesn't even show up to one of our most sacred traditions?
Arron didn't appreciate Adonis talking like he wasn't in the room, but he supposed he didn't have much space to complain.
Well, he has to do Avery's job tomorrow, which I think is punishment enough.
Hey.
Well, it's true.
It's not that bad.
Only to you.
Whatever.
Later that night, after Arron had put his latest treasures in their proper place, he and his brothers prepared to settle down for the night. Arron lay on his back in his bed, fiddling with the purple seashell he always wore around his neck as his mind replayed the events of the day. He'd really screwed up this time, and he felt terrible. In truth, Arron did enjoy singing, and he was really good at it. Sometimes, his emotions would build up so much in his chest that they had no choice but to leave in the form of musical notes. But when he was required to do it, it became a chore, and he lost interest. It killed him that he couldn't share with his brothers the reasons why he was always disappearing or his fascination with the human world. He couldn't remember a time where he didn't want to know everything about them and learn their ways and understand how to navigate the vastly different world that began where the ocean ended. He wanted to know what it was like to have legs and to walk, run, and dance. And he knew that unless he got to experience the human world firsthand, his curiosities would never be satisfied. Queen Athena slowly swam into the prince's room to bid them good night. While the six older ones all chorused their welcomes and good nights, her youngest son wouldn't even look at her. Athena positioned herself next to Aaron's bed and set down her trident.
You're a lot like your father, you know.
Really?
Arron asked with his eyes on his shell.
Stubborn, impulsive, and fights me on everything. Yep, sounds about right. You're so much like him that I worry I'm going to lose you the same way.
Arron finally turned onto his side so he could look at her. King Triton, Queen Athena's husband and Arron's father had died shortly after Arron was born. Merpeople used to take trips up to the surface frequently, or so he had heard. But one day, all of them had been spotted by fishermen on a ship who had tried to capture at least one of the mermaids. Triton had done all he could to protect his family and his people at the cost of his own life when a stray arrow pierced his heart. Since then, the queen and the rest of the merpeople had hardened their hearts towards humankind, and trips to the surface were strictly forbidden. Athena didn't show it very often, as she had to be a queen before anything, but her sons could see just how much she missed her other half. Arron could understand why she created the ban, but he didn't share her feelings about humans in the slightest. Surely all of them couldn't be like the horrible ones who had killed his father and king.
My boys mean everything to me. Do you know how much it would hurt me if anything were to happen to any of you?
Arron felt guilty for making his mother worry about him. But she didn't understand how much he craved to know humans, and she never would. Athena gently began stroking Aaron's red hair. Despite being close to adulthood, a merman wasn't considered a full adult until he reached 20 years of age, Arron never truly minded when she did that. So many times when they were together, she had to be his queen. Moments like this were when she got to be his mother. Her melodic voice reached his ears as she began to sing a soft lullaby.
Where the north wind meets the sea, there's a river full of memory. Sleep, my darling, safe and sound, for in this river all is found.
All mermaids and mermen had beautiful singing voices, as they were close relatives of the sirens. But Arron was sure that his mother's voice was more beautiful than all of them. Even all of his brothers lay in their own beds, listening to their mother's voice with rapt attention, as it caressed them with love and warmth. Most people insisted that Arron had been lucky enough to have her voice within him, and it was why his presence had been so vital to the competition today. The sirens used their ethereal voices to sink ships and drown the passengers. And Arron was beyond thankful that the merpeople didn't do the same, despite their hatred of humankind. At least his mother had some kind of boundaries. Hating the humans and separating themselves from them was one thing, but actively working to take the life of one was something else entirely. Even she shared his dislike of the sirens as she found them callous and unpredictable.
In her waters, deep and true, lie the answers and a path for you. Dive down deep into her sound, but not too far you'll be drowned.
The idea of a mermaid or a merman drowning had always seemed ridiculous. But when Arron was a young child, Athena had explained to him that it was metaphorical. In this context, it meant if he went too far seeking something he desired, he may not be able to come back from it.
Yes, she will sing to those who hear, and in her song all magic flows. But can you brave what you most fear? Can you face what the river knows? Where the north wind meets the sea, there's a mother full of memory. Come, my darling, homeward bound, when all is lost, then all is found.
By the time Athena finished her song, all of her sons had fallen asleep. She gently kissed each of their foreheads and smiled as she swam out of the room to return to her own royal chambers. Chapter 2. A Fateful Meeting. Arron banged his forehead on the desk inside the Royal Library. He'd been in here since he had woken up this morning, and he would be here until it was time for him to go to sleep. He didn't understand how Avery found this entertaining. Transcribing intricately detailed Atlantican history for hours on end was definitely not his idea of fun. What was even worse was that he was forced to be in here alone so he could concentrate. Two guards were posted at the door to ensure that no one disturbed him, but Arron was sure that his mother had stationed them there to make sure he didn't sneak off early. He much rather would have been on guard duty. It was just as boring because nothing ever happened, and the few things that did were usually because of him. But at least he'd be out in the open instead of stuck inside this suffocating room. This was the longest day of his life. Just when Arron was about to practically destroy the entire library as a way to absolve himself of the crippling boredom, the door opened and Avery swam inside. The sight of another face after hours of being in a room by himself was such a welcome sight that Arron didn't even care that Avery was probably only here to tease him.
Whoa! You don't look so good.
And you're the epitome of beauty?
Jeez, don't be such a piranha.
Oh, I don't know how you do this almost every day. I feel like I'm dying on the inside.
Quit being overdramatic. Learning about our history is important for a prince.
I'm seventh in line. It's not like I'm going to be ruling anytime soon.
Probably not. But that doesn't mean that Adonis or Arden aren't going to need our counsel in the future. And hey, you never know what could happen.
I guess.
Is there any job you actually do like? I mean, you're good at so many things, but you don't really like anything.
Arron liked hunting for human treasures, but he couldn't exactly tell his brother that.
Can you just go? I have to get through this entire stack by tonight.
Actually, Mom said that you're free to go.
Wait, what?
She said you've been punished enough. Get out of here and go let off some steam.
You are my favorite brother right now.
Yeah, let me see how much you screwed up my stuff.
Hey, I did a great job. Look for yourself. I'm getting out of here.
Before Avery changed his mind or told him that it was a joke, Arron swam through the library doors and then out of the palace as fast as he could to feel the wondrous expanse of the ocean. After spending so much time in that horrid, cramped room, he finally felt like he could breathe again.
Arron! Finished with your grounding?
I wasn't grounded. I would have preferred that.
He looked around him to ensure that no one was around to follow them.
Come on.
Arron and Angel swam a good distance away from the palace until they arrived at a small and abandoned grotto. Arron pulled back the large stone that covered the entrance, which blocked any prying eyes from seeing that it was not a normal grotto at all. Inside was every single human treasure Arron had collected over the years. The entire space was covered in various objects, most of which he didn't understand their use or purpose. Arron loved coming here when he needed some time to himself. Things always seemed to make sense in this space, cut off from the rest of his world and immersed in someone else's. He sighed as he fiddled with his most recent find, the Dinglehopper.
I guess I can understand why Mom doesn't like humans. If I had been in her position, maybe I wouldn't either. But surely a species who makes such amazing stuff like all of this, well, can't be all bad, right?
Before Angel could answer, something crashed inside the grotto and Arron's heart nearly stopped. A noise like that meant someone had discovered his hidden place, and that meant that he was in a lot of trouble.
Serena?
He exclaimed when he saw the small red crab tangled up in some of his treasures. Serena glared at him as she tried to remove all of the items entrapping her.
Arron, what? How? What is all this?
Nothing.
Nothing? Oh, this is definitely something.
What are you even doing here?
Your mother assigned me to watch over you.
I'm 18. I don't need a babysitter.
Yes, you've proven that very well lately. Now explain what all of this is doing here.
It's just my collection.
Oh, of course. Your collection.
She angrily threw off the last two objects.
If your mother knew about this place, she'd crack
me! You're not gonna tell her, are you?
You can't! Please, Serena, she'd be furious. She'd never understand why I wanted to collect all of this. And she definitely won't give me a chance to explain.
Okay. I know that as a prince, you're under a lot more pressure than the average merman. So, why don't we just leave here, never come back, and pretend that none of this ever happened? Come along now.
Before Serena could force Arron out of the grotto and back home, the entire space darkened as something very large passed by overhead. Arron looked up and could only see the bottom of some kind of vessel as it floated on the surface of the water.
What is that?
The red-haired merman swam out of the grotto's entrance and up towards the mysterious floating thing.
No! No, 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 no! Come back! Wrong way! The palace is this way!
Lighten up, Siri.
It's Serena!
Arron chuckled to himself as he continued upward. There was no better way to rile up Serena than to abbreviate her name. Arron broke the surface of the water and his jaw dropped in amazement. The huge and marvelous ship sailing through the ocean wasn't what impressed him most, though it was stunning to see an actual moving ship rather than a sunken one. But what was even more amazing was the sparkling colors bursting in the air with loud crackles and booms. He had known humans could do incredible things, but he had never known that they could make colors just appear in the air like that. Angel and Serena surfaced next to him.
Arron, what do you think you're...
Her eyes widened when she saw the ship and the magical colors.
Jumping jellyfish!
Arron dove into the water and began swimming closer to the ship.
Arron, come back!
The merman excitedly swam up to the ship, careful not to let any of the passengers see him. Maybe this was really, really stupid of him, considering how his father had perished. But his curiosity overrode his better judgment. This could be his chance to prove that not all humans were the evil, greedy, fish-hunting barbarians his mother wanted to believe they were. A small opening on the side of the ship allowed him to peek onto the main deck. He smiled as he watched some of the sailors play instruments and create music with their snarflats while others danced around on their two legs. All of his childhood dreams were suddenly fulfilled in this one instant. He'd never been able to see humans so close before, and this created an entirely new level of interest for him. An animal with an enormous amount of hair covering its entire body bounced in between all of the people with excited yelps and barks, but none of them seemed bothered by its rambunctious movement. Then it froze and sniffed the air. Arron watched it move closer and closer to the little opening, and he quickly pressed his back to the ship before the creature saw him. When he went to peek through the opening again, he found himself face to face with the animal. It excitedly licked his face and barked again.
Maxine!
The animal pranced over to the voice's owner while Arron wiped his cheek.
Come here, girl. What are you doing over there, huh? Careful you don't get dragged in by a shark. As if I would ever let a shark get you.
Arron looked at the person the animal had run over to, and his breath caught in his throat. While he was aware that he'd never seen a human woman with his own eyes before, he couldn't imagine any of them being more beautiful than the girl on the deck. Her full, black hair tied into a half ponytail was knotted and tangled from constantly being blown about by the wind. She wore a simple white blouse and a long blue skirt with a red sash. Her deep red lips parted in a smile as she swished her skirt around in her hands and danced across the deck, her black boots giving satisfying rhythmic clicks on the wood. It took everything Arron had to not call out to her.
All right, quiet down, everyone.
The instruments stopped playing as each passenger gave the woman their attention.
It is now my honor and privilege to present our esteemed Princess Erica with her birthday present, specially crafted just for her. Happy birthday, Princess.
One of the sailors removed a large piece of cloth to reveal a statue of the princess underneath. The statue was wearing a very large ball gown with her hair pulled back into an extravagant bun, and her face was deadly serious. Arron frowned. If that statue was supposed to be the black-haired girl who was apparently a princess, then someone had done a very terrible job.
Oh my. Wow. It's really something.
It looks nothing like you, does it? I think I was cheated.
Erica laughed, a light and musical sound that made Aaron's heart skip a couple beats.
I appreciate the gesture, Grimhilda, but you know that I prefer not to receive birthday presents. I've already been given so much. Spending time out at sea is perfect enough.
Arron smiled, appreciating any human who loved the ocean.
Well, I confess that I initially had it created as a wedding present, though I believe considering its outcome, it's unfit for either occasion.
I'm sorry I didn't fall for the Prince of Glowerhaven.
Oh, my dear. Pardon my frankness, but he was an oaf, and you are much better off without him. It's just that the entire kingdom has felt a great hole since the loss of your mother and father. We want to see you happily married as they were, so that you may take your place upon the throne.
I don't see why I have to marry to take the throne.
The duty of a queen is a very heavy burden, one that should not be faced alone, especially at your age. It is by finding someone to share the burden with you that the kingdom can find peace.
But I don't want to marry simply to become queen. My parents were in an arranged marriage and just happened to be lucky enough to fall for each other later. I don't want to risk that won't happen to me. I want to wait until I find the right person.
How will you know?
I just will. You can't explain what love feels like, but you know it when you find it.
The darkened sky lit up with a flash of light, followed by a loud rumble of thunder. Quicker than seemed possible, the wind picked up and the ship careened through waves larger than the ship itself.
Hurricane a coming! Stand fast! Secure the rigging!
My lady, get below deck, quickly!
No! I have to help!
Princess, your safety must come first!
My life is no more important than the lives of my men! You may either help or go down below, and I won't judge your decision either way. But I will not sit in safety while they risk their lives to keep us afloat.
Having enough experience to know what to do in a storm, Erica and the other sailors tried to tie up the sails before they were damaged by the wind and lightning. The wind quickly became so fierce that Arron lost his grip on the side of the ship and plunged back down into the water below. He resurfaced once again, and to his horror, a bolt of lightning hit one of the sails and began to envelop it in bright orange flame. He'd never seen fire before, but he knew of its ability to destroy anything it touched. He could feel the painful heat of it even from a distance. Unable to steer with the wind, waves, and the growing fire, the ship crashed into a large pile of rocks, which sent several people overboard. Up on the main deck, Erica coughed from the smoke consuming the easily flammable ship. She quickly tried to make her way to the railing to ensure that everyone had abandoned the burning vessel.
Princess!
She heard Grimhilda's voice call from down in the water where several of the sailors had gathered inside a surviving lifeboat. Maxine's urgent barks joined in with the other voices frantically calling for her. Erica was just about to jump overboard herself when she noticed the slumped over figure of a man and saw that his foot had become trapped in a hole in the deck. Sweat rolling down her temples, she kicked the surrounding wood with her boot as hard as she could. The damaged wood easily broke just enough for the sailor to pull his foot out. Erica put the man's arm around her neck and helped him to the side of the ship. With as much grace as she could, she pushed the man overboard to be helped by the others in the lifeboat below. Erica felt her vision going hazy, and it was difficult to breathe. She needed to jump and get into the cool water, away from this heat. She needed to. Exhausted and suffocated, Erica fell over onto the deck unconscious. The flames reached the stock of gunpowder below deck, and it exploded in a blaze of fire and smoke.
Princess!
Horrified, Arron dove into the water and frantically searched the floating wreckage for the raven-haired princess. Just when he'd about lost any hope of her surviving the blast, he caught sight of a blue skirt and white shirt sinking beneath the water. Arron dove after the girl and hooked his arm around her waist. Then he carefully swam back up to the surface, making sure to keep the girl's head above water at all times. Arron closed his eyes and focused. As a creature of the ocean, he could innately tell where the sea ended and land started. As soon as he could sense the nearest shore, he frantically pushed for that direction. It was a difficult task to swim while holding on to someone who wouldn't allow him to dive under, and there were a few times his lungs begged for the reprieve of the ocean, but he refused to stop until he made it to the sandy beach with the princess. Helping her up on land when he didn't have feet also proved to be a challenging task itself, and by this point, he was on the brink of exhaustion. Arron didn't know a lot about human anatomy beyond their legs, or what to do when one of them nearly died from an explosion, followed by almost drowning. He wasn't even sure she was still alive after all that. Seeing the commotion from overhead, Scuttle landed next to them while Angel and Serena finally caught up with him and watched from the ocean.
Is she dead?
Hard to say,
Scuttle answered as she examined the girl's body. She took her foot and pressed it up against her head.
Oh, I can't make out a heartbeat.
Suddenly, Erica coughed up some seawater, and Arron thought he might burst with relief at the sign of life. He turned her on her side, guessing that if he didn't, she might choke on the water trying to expel itself from her body. When he lay her flat on her back again, she remained unconscious, but she began to shake terribly. What was he supposed to do now? Was the shaking a good thing? Did it mean her body was trying to heal itself from the damage it had endured? Arron gently pressed his hand to her cheek. He was almost positive that humans weren't supposed to be this cold. He carefully took the girl into his arms so that she would warm up against his body. After several minutes, her shivering stopped, and she relaxed in his hold.
I think she's okay.
He gently moved some of her wet black hair away from her face.
She's beautiful.
Arron could feel notes rising up in his chest and throat, the way they did whenever he felt excited or anxious, begging to be released. Unlike the sirens who led humans to their demise, he wanted his voice to lead her back to life. He softly began to sing to her, similar to how his mother always had.
What would I give to live where you are? What would I pay to stay here beside you? What would I do to see you smiling at me? Where would we walk? Where would we run? If we could stay all day in the sun, just you and me, and I could be part of your world.
The girl's beautiful blue eyes slowly opened, fulfilling Aaron's hope that his song would help her awaken once again. Arron would have been content to stay there and hold her forever, but the furry animal from before barked and yelped as it raced towards them.
Princess! Princess Erica!
Arron quickly but gently laid the princess down onto the sand and dove into the water before anyone saw him. Maxine reached the princess and whimpered as she gently licked her face. Still only half conscious, Erica lightly rubbed her hand over Maxine's head. Grimhilda gasped as she saw the princess's waterlogged and singed body lying on the beach.
Oh, princess!
She quickly knelt at the girl's side and helped her stand again.
Thank goodness you're alive. You had me so worried.
Someone was here. Someone saved me.
Who?
I don't know, but his voice, it was so beautiful.
Come on, dear. Let's get you back to the palace and get you looked at by the physician.
But the man who was here...
Erica swayed and nearly fell over again, but Grimhilda quickly caught her.
It's all right, dear. You're going to be okay.
Erica felt someone lift her off her feet and carry her back up to her palace that she had thought for a moment she would never see again. She wanted to say that she was perfectly capable of walking back on her own, but even she knew it was a lie. She could only rest as someone carried her away from her savior. In her last moments of consciousness, Erica swore that she would find that person, whatever it took. Arron watched as one of the sailors from the ship carried the princess away from the ocean. His heart fluttered inside his chest and ached with a deep longing to be near her again.
Okay, let's all agree that the queen is never to find out about this.
She glared at Angel.
That means you. No one speaks of it. And we may all just get out of this alive.
Come on. Let's get back.
The princess's deep ocean blue eyes continued to pierce his thoughts and refused to leave, no matter how much he tried to stop thinking about her. Serena was right that none of them should speak of this moment. But he also knew that from here on out, nothing was ever going to be the same. Chapter 3. A Terrible Mistake. Arron quietly hummed to himself as he prepared to head out with Atticus and Apollo to the training grounds where they would work with some of the up-and-coming soldiers. He may have a special knack for singing, but Arron was also no stranger to a sword. From the moment he was able to swim on his own, each merprince had trained with swords, spears, or weapons of his choosing until their arms and tails were bruised and sore. After all, in the event of an attack on the kingdom, all of them were expected to be at the front lines to defend their home. Though Apollo was the best swordsman in Atlantica, with Atticus close behind, all of them were more than capable of holding their own should the occasion call for it.
Ready to go?
Sure. Are you feeling okay?
Yeah, of course. Why?
You hate going to the training grounds. Why are you so anxious to get there? And why are you humming?
No reason. It's just a good day today.
Right.
Queen Athena swam into the prince's room.
Boys, come on, you're going to be late. What example are you going to teach these recruits if you can't be there on time?
My apologies, mother.
Arron said with a polite bow.
We were just leaving. Come on, guys.
Arron resumed humming as he slipped out of the room towards the training grounds, while his family stared after him.
Who was that? Because I'm pretty sure that wasn't my son.
Asa and Avery smiled at each other.
He has all the symptoms.
Symptoms? Symptoms of what? Is he sick?
No. I think Arron might be in love.
What? How did he fall in love before me?
Maybe it's because he doesn't have the personality of a barracuda.
I am very loving!
His mother and brothers turned to look at him in unison as the way he spoke proved the statement very false. Adonis looked away from them.
I will work on that.
Come on.
Atticus motioned to Apollo.
Let's go before Loverboy scares the new recruits away.
Athena smiled as she watched her two sons leave the room. Most of the princes enjoyed gazing at the mermaids from afar, and some of them had engaged in a fling here and there with a mermaid in their teenage years. But Arron had never seemed even the slightest bit interested in anyone in the kingdom. Athena had since accepted that her carefree and spirited son just didn't want a mate. But it brought her joy to see that she had been wrong.
Whoever the lucky mermaid is must be very special.
Serena couldn't take this kind of pressure anymore. Not only was she in charge of Arron now, which was an impossible task and rather cruel of Queen Athena to ask of her, but she had also watched as he broke about 10 different merfolk laws. How could she convince him to forget everything he saw and did and just move on with his life down here? How could she show him that life was better under the water rather than on land with the humans? And most importantly, how did she make sure that the queen never found out about what had happened? She'd never had to lie to the queen before, and her shell ached just thinking about it. One of the merman soldiers swam up to the little crab and gave her a small bow.
Madam Serena, Queen Athena would like to see you.
The queen?
Yes, something to do with Prince Arron.
The crab fought off every impulse to hide in her shell and not come out until this whole thing blew over.
Okay, this doesn't mean she knows what happened. This could be about anything. The key is to not panic.
She took a very deep breath and made her way to the throne room. Prince Adonis and Prince Arden sat on either side of the queen. As the two eldest princes, they were next in line for the throne, and the queen had had them begin to sit in on meetings and deliberations when she felt they were ready. Adonis had started as soon as he had come of age, since he was first in the royal line, and was now on his 8th year of instruction. Arden had joined them when he turned 23 and was in his 3rd year. Of course, this was an official court business, but being the eldest princes came with perks.
Good morning, Serena.
Good. Good morning, Your Majesty.
Serena, I was hoping you could help me understand something.
My lady?
Have you noticed that Arron has been acting a little peculiar lately?
Peculiar?
Oh, humming to himself, eager to complete his royal duties, actually getting along with his brothers. You haven't noticed any of that.
You know,
As the one who's tasked with looking after him, then surely you know the reason for this rather odd behavior.
Well, actually, I...
Serena, I know you've been keeping something from me.
Oh, no, no, Your Majesty. I wouldn't.
Oh, I understand. Boys don't want to talk to their mother about something like this, right? Arron is in love. And you know who he's in love with, don't you?
I...
Serena couldn't stay quiet any longer. Clearly, the Queen already knew what had happened somehow and was baiting her to admit it herself.
I tried to stop him, m'lady. I swear I did. He just wouldn't listen. I told him to stay away from humans. I told him that they're bad and they bring trouble, but he just...
Wait, humans?
Her hand curled around her trident as her eyes filled with such deep and powerful anger that Serena would have preferred that she was on the end of a fishhook.
What about humans?
Serena's frantically beating heart nearly came out of her throat as she realized her grievous error. She had been worried about Angel accidentally spilling the secret, but it was she who had incriminated Arron. Adonis and Arden rose from their thrones as they looked at Serena with stunned faces, then back at their mother.
Human?
Serena nervously laughed, hoping that there was some way she could undo what had been done.
Said anything about humans? Certainly not me. Okay, I did, but I was just joking.
Athena tightly gripped her trident in her hand and swam out of the throne room. Arden and Adonis shared a nervous glance. However they felt about their youngest brother, none of them wished to be in his fins right now.
Come on, Angel, just tell me what's going on.
If I told you, then it wouldn't be a surprise. Come on, we're almost there.
Angel led Arron back to the grotto. Arron pulled the stone away and swam inside after his friend.
Angel, what could you...
Arron stopped speaking when he saw Angel's present. Somehow, the little fish had managed to get the statue of Princess Erica, which had gone down in the wreck, into the grotto. The statue still didn't resemble the girl he'd seen and saved a few nights ago, but it was still her.
Angel, this is the best gift anyone's ever given me!
He eagerly swam up to the statue.
It's amazing!
I knew you'd like it!
He touched the statue's hair, wishing that it was down around her shoulders instead of tied back. Her thick hair deserved to be as free as the rest of her. He then ran a gentle finger across her lips and desired to see her smiling like she had on the ship. But none of that mattered right now. He would take this recreation of the princess until he managed to figure out a way to see the real thing again and tell her that he was the one who had saved her life. But then, a figure appeared in the entrance of the grotto, and Arron thought he might be sick. Queen Athena. Athena looked at the space filled with human treasures, and her fierce grip on her trident tightened even more. Adonis and Arden floated a short distance behind her, looking at Arron with pity and concern. And next to them was Serena. Arron immediately knew who was to blame for his mother finding his hidden treasure trove.
Mother, I can explain.
I consider myself a reasonable mermaid and queen. I set certain rules, and I expect those rules to be obeyed.
His insides chilled at her deadly tone that she only reserved for when she was moments away from using her trident on something. Arron had been on the receiving end of the trident's power in his youth, and it was an experience he never wanted to repeat.
Mother!
Putting aside what I'm seeing right now, is it true that you rescued a human from drowning?
I had to!
You had to? Arron, contact between the human world and our world is strictly forbidden! You know that! Everyone knows that!
But she would have died!
One less human to worry about! Was your father's death not enough to convince you of their evil ways?
You can't condemn an entire species based on the actions of a few of them!
Humans are all the same. Spineless, savage, harpooning fish hunters, incapable of feeling any emotion!
Mom, stop! This girl is different. I know it. I think I might be in love with her.
Right away, Arron knew that was the wrong thing to say. His mother's eyes glazed over with a glaring fury that he had only ever seen one other time in his life when someone threatened the life of Atticus when he was a teenager. He never thought that it would be possible for her to be this angry at him.
You love this girl. You love this human.
Arden started forward.
Mother,
Athena spun around and both Arron and Adonis shrunk a little under her harsh glare.
Enough! Did you two know about this?
No! No one knew about this place. I didn't tell anyone.
Arron, I have given you far too many passes. I'm sorry, but you have left me no choice.
Her trident began to glow.
Wait, Mom!
Athena lifted up the trident and a spark of power completely incinerated an entire shelf of Arron's possessions.
No!
He tried to swim up to her and take the trident from her before she did any more damage. But Adonis and Arron each took one of his arms to hold him back, if only to keep Arron from hurting himself in an attempt to stop their mother's rampage.
Mother, stop!
He watched as the hundreds of objects he had taken years to collect, had battled sharks and stingrays and poisonous fish to secure, had studied each and every one until there was nothing left to learn, were obliterated by the power from the Queen's trident. Finally, Athena turned and glared at the statue of Princess Erica.
No! No, please don't!
With an especially powerful burst of magic, Athena used the trident to shatter the statue of the girl he had rescued and fallen for. His oldest brothers finally released him, unintentionally leaving bruises on his arms from their tight grips. Arron sank to the floor of the grotto and surveyed the wreckage. Everything he'd ever cherished, everything he'd ever adored, everything he'd ever worked for, gone in the span of 30 seconds. Athena gripped her trident in her hand and swam out of the grotto to leave her son to come to his senses.
Arron,
Arron said softly as he gently put his hand on his brother's shoulder. Arron flinched away from his touch.
Just get out.
Adonis and Arron shared another pained glance. While they could never understand what Arron saw in the humans and why he adored their world so much, both of them couldn't imagine the pain of losing an entire collection of objects he clearly cherished, and at his own mother's hand, no less. With nothing they could say, the two oldest princes slowly swam out of the grotto, even though it didn't seem right to leave him alone. Serena slowly scuttled up to him.
Arron, I didn't mean to.
Arron furiously spun around.
You told her.
I...
You told her.
I'm sorry. I just...
Arron glared at her with a hot fury that scarily resembled his mother's.
I never want to see you again.
Serena felt like someone had smashed her shell. She had watched the little prince grow since his birth, and even if he drove her crazy most of the time, she had a very soft spot for the young merman.
Arron...
Go.
With a heavy sigh, Serena quietly scuttled out of the grotto. Angel stayed behind for a few seconds longer, but as much as she wished that she could cheer him up like he always did for her, she knew there were no words that could mend the pain he was feeling. Sadly, she exited the grotto as well. Arron picked up some of the remains of his treasures and tried to decipher what it had been to see if it was at all salvageable, but it was charred and damaged beyond recognition. He angrily threw the pieces into the opposite wall and ran his hands over his face in frustration and misery.
Poor child. Poor sweet child.
Arron looked up to see two moray eels slither into his grotto.
He has a very serious problem.
If only there was something we could do.
But there is something.
Who are you? How did you get in here?
Don't be scared.
I'm not scared. I'm just not in the mood for company. So unless you have some way to turn back time and give me back what I've lost, then just leave me alone.
Well, we can't bring things back. But we do know someone who could give you something even better.
Just imagine.
You and your princess.
The two eels intertwined themselves and said at the same time,
Together. Forever.
What are you talking about?
One of the eels curled around him, which made him shiver, and whispered,
Ursulus has great powers.
The sorcerer? But he was banished years ago. Everyone's believed him to be dead.
Just because you can't see something doesn't mean it's not there.
No. No, I could never do that to...
He started to say he couldn't do that to his mother. But right now, after what she'd done, He wasn't really concerned with her feelings or what he should and shouldn't be doing. But consorting with the sorcerer who'd nearly taken over the kingdom before he was born was drawing a line that he knew he shouldn't cross.
No, I couldn't do that. Just get out.
Suit yourself,
one of the eels hissed as they started to slither away.
It was only a suggestion.
Arron watched them leave and found himself entertaining the idea. He was foolish to even consider it because it was a well-known fact amongst the merfolk that Ursulus the sorcerer was not to be trusted. But what would be the harm in just going and seeing what he could do for him? Ursulus may be the only one who could give him the chance to be with Princess Erica. If Arron didn't like what he offered, then he just wouldn't make a deal. He'd go back home and pretend it never happened. And even though he knew it was petty, and that he shouldn't be making decisions when his heated emotions were swirling so violently inside him, nothing would spite his mother more than consorting with her mortal enemy.
Wait.
The two eels turned around with slippery smiles.
Yes?
Take me to him.
Chapter 4. Deal with the Devil. Serena had never felt so awful in her entire life. Aaron's words replayed over and over again in her head and stung just as much as the first time he'd said them.
I never want to see you again. I never want to see you again.
She was almost sure that he would eventually forgive her. But there was a chance he wouldn't, and she didn't know if she'd be able to bear that. Figures passing overhead caught her and Angel's attention. Serena frowned when she realized that it was Arron swimming between two moray eels who wore unnerving grins.
Arron, where are you going? What are you doing with this riffraff?
I thought I said I never wanted to see you again.
Arron.
But if you must know, I'm going to see Ursulus.
Serena's eyes widened in horror, and she frantically tried to pull on Aaron's tail to make him stop.
What? Arron, I know you're angry and upset, but think about what you're doing. He's a demon and a monster.
Well, then why don't you go and tell my mother? You're good at that. And you know, I might not even mind her knowing about this.
Serena stared after him, trying to think of some way to respond. She looked back in the direction of the palace and considered going to retrieve the queen to get her to put a stop to this nonsense. But she'd already betrayed Arron's trust once today, and it had cost him more than he'd ever imagined. The only reason he was going to Ursulus at all was because of her mistake. And there was no telling what Ursulus might do to him in the time it took for her to explain what was going on to the queen and then the travel time to the sorcerer's lair. She groaned in frustration and motioned for Angel to follow her as they trailed Arron and the two eels. The eels led Arron to a dark and cold part of the ocean to which few merfolk ever ventured. Before long, they approached a large skeleton of some kind of very old fish Arron had never seen before. The eels started towards the entrance, but Arron hesitated. Maybe this wasn't such a good idea. No, he reminded himself. He wasn't going through with anything yet. He just wanted to learn about the sorcerer's magic. Arron followed the eels through the mouth of the skeleton and grimaced when he saw that the entire entranceway was covered in small, moaning and wailing polyps. He swallowed nervously as he made his way forward. One of the polyps shot out and grasped his wrist. Arron frantically tried to break out of its tight grip, again beginning to regret his decision. The polyp reluctantly released him, and Arron floated as high above them as possible so none of them could snatch him again.
Come in, little prince. We mustn't lurk in doorways, it's rude. One might question your upbringing.
Arron swam through the entranceway until he was in the very belly of the decomposed fish. He didn't really know what he expected to see when he laid eyes on the sorcerer, but his stomach clenched when he finally came into view. The entire lower half of his body was made up of 8 black tentacles instead of a tail. Well-built muscles stood out on his purple-tinged skin that contrasted with his full white hair. Arron supposed that if one was banished, it left plenty of time to work on one's physique. Or he had just used magic to make himself look better. Which would be a rather admittedly smart move, because Arron could think of several mermaids who would be unable to resist his dangerous allure. The sorcerer turned around to face him with a devilish smile.
Now then, you're here because you have a thing for this human girl, this princess. I can't say I blame you. She's quite a catch, isn't she?
As a sorcerer chuckled softly, Arron felt like he had swum right into a fisherman's net and had no hope of escaping, even if he wanted to. He wanted to believe that the eels had been the ones to tell the sorcerer of Aaron's predicament, but something told him the sorcerer probably found out using his own means.
The solution to your problem is simple. The only way to get what you want is to become a human yourself.
Suddenly, all thoughts of caution fled out of Aaron's mind. A chance to become human? A chance to live in the world above the sea with Erica? All he'd ever wanted was to experience life as a human.
You can do that?
Ursula smirked to reveal two pointed fangs on both his upper and lower teeth.
My dear, sweet child, that's what I do. It's what I live for. If being banished has been good for anything, it was to show me what my true purpose is. To help unfortunate merfolk like yourself.
He gently put his index finger beneath Aaron's chin.
Poor, unfortunate souls with no one else to turn to.
Arron nervously pressed his lips together, uneager to hear just how the sorcerer planned on making him human.
Come,
he beckoned as he slithered over to the large cauldron.
I now choose to use my magic on the miserable, lonely, and depressed.
He conjured two images of a mermaid and a merman.
The girl wants to be prettier. The guy wants to get the girl, and so I give them what they want.
Ursula snapped his fingers, and the two figures transformed into young and attractive merpeople. The figures looked at themselves, then each other, in surprise, and eagerly hugged.
Unfortunately, sometimes they are unable to pay the price, and I'm afraid I don't have any choice but to take what I am owed.
He snapped again, and the figures turned into the same polyps from inside the entranceway. Arron felt ill as he realized the polyps had all been mermaids and mermen at one point. He'd suspected as much, but this confirmed it. The polyp that had attacked him earlier had probably been trying to get him to turn around before he ended up like them. He wondered if there was anyone who had made a deal with Ursulus and actually came out okay in the end. Ursulus put an arm around Aaron's shoulders.
Here's the deal, my young prince. I will make you a potion that will turn you into a human for 3 days.
Only 3 days?
Don't be greedy. It may be longer, but that depends on you.
He conjured up another image in the cauldron of three setting suns.
Before the sun sets on the 3rd day, you've got to get that darling little princess to fall in love with you.
A glowing heart lifted up to rest inside a golden crown.
That is, if she's got to kiss you. But not just any kiss, the kiss of true love. If she does kiss you before the sun sets on the 3rd day, you'll remain human permanently.
Arron smiled at a moving image of himself with legs.
But if she doesn't, you'll turn back into a merman.
The image warped to give him a tail again, and the cauldron roughly sucked the image inside of it.
And you belong to me.
Arron thought he heard someone say his name, but his thoughts were too centered around this sudden monumental decision before him. And besides, who would have been stupid enough to follow him inside here? Ursula circled around him, his tentacles slowly slithering across Aaron's arms and shoulders, which made it difficult for him to think clearly.
Have we got a deal?
If I become human, I'll never see my mother or brothers again.
Though right now, that seemed more like a blessing than a curse. A part of him thought that this would show his mother that she should listen to him instead of immediately destroying everything he held dear in her blind rage. And maybe it would show his brothers that they couldn't just treat him however they wanted and expect no consequences. But then, Arron wasn't an idiot, and he knew that his brothers cared about him in their own way. Even Adonis, the one he got along with the least, had tried to stop their mother from destroying his possessions earlier. He and Arden had held him back for his own protection, even though they could see how much watching his mother's rampage had killed him inside. Arron knew that Adonis only acted the way he did because he was still grieving the loss of their father even after all this time. Adonis had been 9 years old when King Triton was killed, and he had been closest to their father, having spent the most time with him. The loss had hit him especially hard, and his hatred of humankind rivaled their mother's. And yet, even after seeing all of the possessions Arron had collected, Adonis had still tried to prevent their mother from destroying all of them, and had held him back to protect him. What was he thinking? He couldn't go through with this.
But you'll be with the one you love. And what's better, living the rest of your life with a family who couldn't possibly hope to understand you, or living your life with the only one who can?
Then again, the sorcerer made a good point. He'd always felt distant from the rest of his family, even after 18 years. But he felt a powerful connection with Erica in just a few hours that he wanted to deepen. The thought of never even seeing her again left a painful ache in his chest. This was the only way he could ever hope to be with her.
Oh, and there is one more thing. We'll have to discuss the subject of payment. You can't get something from nothing.
But I don't have any...
One of the tentacles slipped over his mouth to quiet him.
I'm not asking much. Just a token, really, a trifle. You won't even miss it. What I want from you is your voice.
Arron pushed away two of the tentacles slithering around his arms.
Wait, what? You want my voice?
If you want to be with your princess, that is my price.
I'm supposed to get this girl to fall in love with me in 3 days, but I won't be able to even talk to her?
With a face like yours, I'm sure you won't have any trouble at all.
Ursulus began dumping several ingredients into the cauldron, and it flashed with brightly colored light each time something else was added to the potion.
If I get her to kiss me and stay human, will I ever get my voice back?
I'm afraid not. If you want the legs, you lose the voice.
So I won't ever be able to talk to her at all?
Women like it when a man listens anyway. And there are some activities that don't require either of you to say anything.
Aaron's face warmed at the implication.
Make your choice, little prince. Your voice or the princess?
Ursulus snapped his fingers, and a glowing yellow scroll appeared near Aaron's head, outlining the details of their contract. He then held out a fishbone skeleton pen.
Just sign the scroll, and you'll have everything you've ever wanted.
It was now or never. He couldn't pass up the chance to become human and be with Princess Erica. If... hopefully when he earned a kiss from her, he would figure out a way to contact his family and let them know what he'd done. Maybe he could make another deal to get his voice back. Things would all work out in the end if he just played his cards right. As steadily as he could, Arron scrawled out his signature on the bottom of the scroll. Ursulus smiled as if he knew something Arron didn't. Then he began chanting strange words as he waved his hands over the cauldron. Two spindly claws erupted from the cauldron behind him as the entire lair was bathed in eerie green light.
Now sing!
Arron took a deep breath and started singing the first thing that came to his head.
Where the north wind meets the sea, there's a river full of memory. Sleep, my darling, safe and sound. For in this river all is found.
Even in the face of ultimate betrayal, some part of Aaron's heart ached as he automatically sang his mother's lullaby. He wondered if her words rang true, and if he was going too far to get what he wanted. Had he gone so far that he would end up drowning? Well, it was far too late to second-guess himself now. The ghostly claws entered his mouth and sent a deep, unearthly chill all throughout his body. When the chill was gone, he had the distinct feeling that something important was missing. The claws held a glowing orb that hauntingly sang back his mother's lullaby with the voice that no longer belonged to him. His eyes glowing greedily, Ursulus sucked the orb into a nautilus shell and began cackling as smoke poured out of the cauldron and enveloped Arron in its power. What Arron was not prepared for was the unimaginable pain of transforming his green tail into a pair of legs. White, hot pain engulfed him as he felt his tail ripping in two, and he couldn't help screaming in agony. The whole process only took about 15 seconds, but Arron could have sworn the torturous experience lasted an hour. His screams were suddenly cut off when he realized that he had forgotten one crucial detail about transforming. Humans couldn't breathe underwater. Arron tried to kick up, but his weakened form wouldn't move him even an inch closer to precious air. The metaphorical talk about drowning in his mother's song now became a very literal possibility. Serena and Angel, who had been watching the entire time and had tried to stop Arron from making the deal, quickly understood the problem and shot up directly beneath his arms. Arron never thought he'd actually be relieved to see Serena after what had happened. Angel swam as fast as she possibly could, straight out of the fish skeleton and up towards the surface. Being a creature who was able to breathe both in and out of water, Arron had never experienced the feeling of being physically unable to draw in a breath, and it was the most terrifying feeling he'd ever experienced. Just when he thought that he might pass out, Arron burst through the water and took in a deep gulp of air. He could now understand why some humans feared the ocean. He wasn't so sure he wanted to get in the water anymore after that. Breathing heavily, Arron allowed Angel and Serena to help him stay above the water and swim over to the shore. Chapter 5. Meeting the Princess. Erica walked along the beach, softly humming the beautiful song that the mysterious stranger who'd saved her life had sung to her on the beach. That tune, something she never could have come up with herself, was the only proof that she hadn't dreamt the entire encounter. Over the last several days, she'd searched everywhere she possibly could, trying to find the owner of the voice, but she had always come up short. No one resembled who she'd seen, and the few who did couldn't carry a tune to save their lives. Maxine rubbed against her legs as if she'd sensed her owner's lovesick feelings.
I can't get that song out of my head. Who was he? Where could he have gone? Why didn't he stay?
Maxine suddenly stopped walking and sniffed the air. Then she excitedly began to bark and hop around Erica's feet.
Maxine? What's wrong?
The sheepdog eagerly began running down the shore.
Maxine!
The girl called as she quickly hurried after her anxious companion. Serena dragged herself up onto a rock and collapsed while Angel breathed heavily beside her, both of them exhausted from the frantic swim to keep Arron from drowning. Finally catching his breath, Arron sat up in the water and swept his wet hair out of his eyes. And then he caught sight of them. He'd been so distracted by the agonizing pain and the near dying that he'd forgotten why he'd gone through all of that in the first place. But now that it was all over, he could see clearly that the transformation had worked. Instead of a tail, he had human legs. Actual human legs. Suddenly, all of his other problems and all he'd gone through to get here seemed far away. This was everything he'd ever wished for.
Well, look at what the catfish dragged in.
Scuttle flew over their heads before coming to rest on one of Aaron's new legs.
There's something different about you.
Arron eagerly nodded.
Let's see. Don't tell me. Oh, it's your hair, right? You've been using the dinglehopper, haven't you?
Arron smiled and shook his head, then began bouncing his leg up and down to try to give Scuttle a hint.
No? Okay, I gotta admit, I can't put my foot on it right now, but if I just stand here long enough, I know that I'll...
He's got legs, you idiot!
Scuttle squawked and flew off Arron's bouncing leg.
What? Wow!
He traded his voice to the sorcerer and got legs.
The seagull landed next to Serena on the rock.
I knew that.
Arron tried to stand up on his new legs, which proved to be much harder than he thought it would be. They shook underneath him as he attempted to gain his balance. His body had never felt so heavy.
Aaron's been turned into a human. He's got to make the princess fall in love with him, and then she's got to kiss him.
Arron promptly fell back over into the water when his legs refused to keep holding him up. This may be a problem.
And he's only got 3 days. How is 3 days fair? It's not fair. It's just like that sorcerer to create an impossible challenge like this. And you just had to agree to it. Look at him. Human legs. My nerves are shot. This breaks so many laws. I can't even count them all. What would his mother say? I'll tell you what his mother would say. She'd say she's gonna kill herself a crab. That's what his mother would say. Enough of this. I'm just gonna march straight home right now and tell her just like I should have done the second I found out about these.
Arron quickly scooped Serena up into his hands and glared at her. He hadn't forgotten about what she'd done. But then she had helped him to the surface and kept him from drowning. And he knew that it was probably a little harsh of him to say that he never wanted to see her again, because Serena always meant well, even if she sometimes did things Arron didn't like.
Oh, don't give me that look. You're the one who got us all into this mess.
Arron raised an eyebrow.
I mean, back when you rescued that human in the first place. Look, maybe we can fix this. We can get the sorcerer to return your voice. You'll go home and go back with the queen and the other princes, and then you...
She looked at Aaron's hopeful face and faltered. Serena wasn't stupid. She could see how much Arron cared for the human girl and how excited he was to have the chance to be a part of their world. If she told his mother what had happened, Arron would never be let out of the palace again, and the queen might never forgive him.
Oh, you'll just be miserable for the rest of your life. All right. I'll try to help you find that princess.
Arron smiled a little. Scuttle eagerly flapped over to the shore and scoured some of the remains that had washed up from the shipwreck only a few days ago.
Well, if you're gonna be trying to win over this princess, you're gonna have to really dress up. Let's see now.
She held up a ripped portion of the sail from the ship.
Here we are.
Arron took the sail from her and looked at the seagull skeptically.
Well, you gotta put on something. Don't worry, we can make you look irresistible in this.
The redhead shrugged and began attempting to fashion the sail into some kind of covering. After several minutes of struggle in which Arron wished he'd listened more when Apollo had tried to teach him how to tie different knots, he managed to get the sail tied somewhat comfortably around his waist. Unfortunately, there was only enough to cover his lower half, which left his upper half still exposed. He held his hands up at the others, asking what he should do now. No one had time to answer, because Arron heard the distinct sound of an animal barking, the same one from the ship, which meant that the princess probably wasn't far behind. The dog excitedly pranced into their view, and this time, Arron couldn't just swim away. Not knowing anything about dogs or what this one would do to him if it caught him, he quickly climbed up onto a small rocky ledge in an effort to get away from it.
Maxine!
Aaron's heart skipped a beat when he heard the princess's voice.
Come here, girl.
Erica finally appeared on the beach, and Arron once again felt his breath catch. He didn't think it was possible, but she was even more beautiful than he remembered. When Erica noticed her sheepdog prancing around a young man perched on a small ledge who looked terrified of the animal, she firmly clapped her hands twice.
Maxine, come here.
Maxine ran up to her and tried to pull her in the young man's direction.
Why'd you run off like that, huh? What's gotten into you?
She started towards the young man to attempt to talk him off the ledge, and it was then she realized his current state of dress. Her face warmed, and she nervously cleared her throat as she did her best to focus on his face. Arron suddenly felt very embarrassed about how he looked and wished that he'd been able to find something much more suitable to wear before he saw the princess. He didn't want to introduce himself to her looking like this. Maxine continued barking at her almost as if she knew who Arron was. Erica gently pet the dog's fur and tried to keep her back so she didn't frighten the young man any further.
Quiet, girl. I'm so sorry about her. Maxine is harmless, I promise. Are you okay?
Arron smiled at her concern for him and her relationship with her furry companion. Erica's brow furrowed the tiniest bit as she looked at Aaron's eyes.
This is going to seem like a strange question, but have we met before?
Arron quickly nodded as he grinned.
We have? What's your name?
Arron tried to say his name, but only then did he remember how exactly he'd managed to gain human legs.
What is it? What's wrong?
Arron softly touched his throat.
You can't speak?
He shook his head, feeling frustration bubble up inside him at the lack of communication.
I'm sorry. I thought you were someone else.
Arron irritatedly sighed. It just had to be his voice the sorcerer wanted. It couldn't have been literally anything else.
Well, can you write?
Aaron's eyes lit up. Of course he could write. He could still communicate with her after all. It wasn't ideal, but it was certainly better than nothing. He carefully stepped down from the small ledge, noticing that Erica was still doing her best to keep Maxine away from him, and sat himself down onto the sand. Then he used his finger to spell out his name. Erica knelt down next to him to look at what he had written.
Arron, is that your name?
Arron nodded.
Okay, I'm Erica.
He noticed that she didn't introduce herself as a princess, and he liked that, as it told him helping someone in trouble was more important to her than her station.
Do you mind telling me what happened to you and how you got here?
He contemplated what he should write out next. He had so much he wanted to tell her, but it would be a little difficult to explain it all. He couldn't just say that he was a merman and that he'd gone to a magical sea sorcerer to trade his tail for legs, all so that he had a chance to meet her. No one on land would ever believe that. And he definitely couldn't tell her that she had to kiss him in 3 days in order for him to keep his legs and his life. No pressure there. He couldn't even tell her that he was the one who'd saved her, because he couldn't explain why he didn't have a voice anymore. Erica took his pause to mean that he didn't want to talk about it.
You don't have to tell me if you don't want to.
Arron shook his head, trying to show that that wasn't it at all. The girl looked at the torn sail wrapped around his waist.
Were you in a shipwreck?
Arron decided to go with that. It wasn't totally a lie. Technically, a shipwreck did bring him to this moment. He just hadn't exactly been on it.
I'm so sorry. Don't worry, I'll help you.
Arron tried to stand, but his still weak legs didn't like the sudden movement, and he immediately fell over, directly onto the princess. Erica cried out as she tried to catch him, only for both of them to collapse onto the sand. Arron shook his head and opened his eyes to find he was staring down at Erica's face, the purple shell around his neck dangling only inches above her chin. Once they both realized the position they were in, they began blushing, and Arron frantically scurried away from her. He wanted to try to help her up, but he couldn't even trust his own feet to help himself up.
Come on, we'll get you cleaned up and into something a little more comfortable.
She held out a hand for him, but Arron was worried that he would just fall over again if he tried to stand.
It's okay.
He slowly grasped her outstretched hand and allowed her to help him to his unsteady feet. She gently put her other hand onto his back and aided him in his walk back to the palace. It was a little embarrassing that he couldn't walk on his own, but Arron still couldn't help smiling. Chapter 6. The First Day. Erica shuffled around the room as she waited for their newest guest to arrive for dinner. It was strange. With the way he had acted and looked at everything as if he was seeing it all for the first time, it seemed like he had never even been on land before. And then there was his silence. She wondered if he had been mute all of his life or if some kind of trauma had rendered him unable to speak. But it seemed in poor taste for her to ask. If he wanted to tell her, then she would listen, but she wouldn't press him about it. At least his presence might distract her for a while.
Thinking about a certain someone again?
I know everyone thinks I'm crazy, but he was real. The last thing I remember was being on the deck in the middle of the fire. It's simply impossible for me to have gotten all the way to the shore by myself after that.
I don't doubt that someone saved you. Somehow. But I question your infatuation with someone you know nothing about.
I'm not infatuated. I just want to know who he is. But I think I'm getting desperate. For a moment, I thought for sure that Arron was the one who had saved me.
And I suppose since he can't talk, he isn't?
No. The thing I remember the most is his voice. It's just... Do you remember when my mother used to say? She said that the second she laid eyes on my father, she knew that, even if they weren't in an arranged marriage, she wanted to spend the rest of her life with him. I don't know if this is the same, but I do know that when I opened my eyes and saw him and felt his arms around me and heard him singing, I felt something. I have to know who he is. He has to be out there somewhere.
Maybe he doesn't want to be found.
Their conversation stopped when they heard a warm chuckle by the entrance to the banquet hall, which belonged to Carlyle, the princess's butler.
Come on, my boy. Don't be shy.
Erica could feel a blush rise to her cheeks as Arron stepped inside the ballroom where they were to dine. Pink was traditionally not a masculine color, but Erica dared anyone to look at Arron and say that. He had dressed into a pink and white coat with a white undershirt, white breeches, and casual brown boots. The light colors complemented his vibrant red hair, which had now been cleaned and styled.
Wow. You look wonderful. I feel underdressed.
Arron smiled broadly at her as his face warmed again. She could be wearing torn rags, and he would still think she was the most beautiful girl in the world.
Come, dear. You must be famished,
Grimhilda said as she gently led Arron to the table. He took a seat in one of the chairs while Grimhilda sat on the opposite side of the table, and Erica sat at the head.
It's not often we have such a lovely dinner guest.
Arron looked down at the table and saw a dinglehopper sitting next to the other tools and a large circular object. Finally, something he actually knew the name of. He picked up the dinglehopper and started to run it through his hair. When he looked at the other two occupants at the table, he flushed as he realized they were staring at him like he was crazy. Arron quickly put the tool down again.
Carlisle, can you get Arron another fork?
Erica asked, choosing not to question what he had just done. Maybe it was some kind of custom people did wherever it was he came from, and it wasn't her place to question another's way of life. But she wasn't going to let her guest eat with something that had just touched his hair. Arron bit his bottom lip. Fork? That's what this thing was called? And it wasn't for fixing hair? He quickly erased everything he thought he knew about human stuff and made a mental note to throttle that seagull when he saw her again. So much for being an expert on all of the treasures he'd brought to her. Carlisle promptly took away Aaron's fork and replaced it with another.
What's for dinner?
Chef Louise has been fixing her specialty, stuffed crab.
Aaron's heart nearly came out of his throat. Stuffed what? Erica noticed his unease and asked,
Do you not like seafood?
He quickly nodded since he thought it would be rude if he refused to eat the meal Erica's cook had worked so hard to prepare. And it wasn't like he didn't like seafood. He lived in the ocean and a merman had to eat.
Excellent. Chef Louise always makes amazing dishes. She's celebrated as the best cook in the whole kingdom.
Just as she'd finished speaking, a loud series of crashes sounded all the way from the kitchen.
I think I'd better go see what Louise is up to.
He properly began to strut out of the room, then started running when he was closer to the door.
Perhaps our guest might enjoy seeing some of the sights of the kingdom. Maybe you might like to give him a tour?
It took Erica several seconds to realize that Grimhilda had asked her a question. She stopped staring at Arron and looked over at her.
I'm sorry, what was that?
I was saying that perhaps you two could spend the day together tomorrow.
Oh, but tomorrow I have to answer several inquiries. I've been awaiting my response. There's the fitting, and then I have my lessons.
Nothing that can't wait one more day. You've been spending far too much time cooped up in the castle lately. We can manage things around here while you spend some time with our guest.
Well, if you're sure, it has been a while since I've been into town.
Then perfect. I'll make arrangements with the staff this evening and have everything ready by tomorrow morning.
While they talked and finalized their plans for the outing, Carlisle returned to the banquet hall and placed a covered dish in front of each person. Grimhilda's eyes remained on Erica as she lifted up the lid on her plate, so she didn't notice the live crab sitting under the covering. Aaron's eyes widened when he saw Serena in the middle of the greenery resting on the plate. He was pretty sure she was a cause of all the noise they'd heard just a few minutes ago, and thought that being stuck in a kitchen with a chef making a crab-themed meal was more than enough punishment for what had happened this morning. Quickly making sure that Grimhilda and Erica weren't looking, he motioned for Serena to get over to his plate. She quickly scuttled across the table, and Arron slapped on the lid just as Erica turned to look at him.
Would you be interested in taking a tour of the kingdom with me tomorrow?
A whole day alone with Erica, seeing all that the human world had to offer? It couldn't have been more perfect. He eagerly nodded his head.
Wonderful. Now, let's eat before this crab wanders off my plate.
But when she looked down, the only thing on her plate was a pile of lettuce. Once dinner concluded, Erica stood up from her chair.
I'm going for a walk on the beach before I retire.
All right. but don't stay up too late. You're going to have a busy day tomorrow.
Of course.
She turned to look at Arron.
If you'd like to join me, you're more than welcome.
Of course he wanted to spend more time with her. He could spend every moment with her for the rest of his life, and it wouldn't be enough. But he nodded once, since he felt like he'd been showing a little too much enthusiasm lately.
Then come with me.
She led him outside the palace and then down to the beach. When their feet hit the sand, Erica slipped off her shoes, and Arron copied her action.
You can take off your coat if you'd like. I don't want you to be uncomfortable.
He removed his pink and white coat as well, so he was now only wearing his white shirt and breeches. The sand still felt very strange between his toes as he followed Erica down to the water. She let the tide run over her bare feet, but Arron thought it might be best not to let any seawater touch him for now. If his mother was able to sense his presence through contact with the ocean and tried to bring him back home by force, she would be unaware that she would kill her son if she did. Erica noticed Arron staying away from the water, and she put her hands to her mouth in embarrassment.
You're scared of the water, aren't you? I'm so sorry, I shouldn't have brought you here.
Arron quickly shook his head and held up his hands. He did recall that one horrible moment where he thought he was going to drown, but it wasn't enough to make him want to stay out of the water forever. Even if he did have legs now, it was still his home.
Are you sure?
Arron nodded. Erica began walking along the shoreline, close enough that the occasional tide still ran over her feet, and Arron walked along the other side of her in order to stay dry. He had mostly gained control of his new legs, but they were still a little sore, and he was glad that she walked slowly.
There's no shame if you are. I know a lot of people who are afraid of the sea. Even I admit that it can be pretty terrifying sometimes. My parents died in a shipwreck 4 years ago.
Arron looked at her sadly.
I don't have any brothers or sisters either. It's just me now.
He felt a pang of guilt when he realized that she didn't have any family, while he had a mother and 6 brothers whom he took for granted every day, and especially now. He wondered if they were worried about him. He had been gone for almost an entire day. No. Arron couldn't start having any regrets now. He needed to focus on his current goal.
I know it must seem like I'm lonely, but I still have Grimhilda and the rest of the servants in the palace, and they all love me as one of their own. So, I guess you could say that I'm luckier than anyone because I have a huge family full of people who care about me, even if they're not directly related to me. What about you? Do you have any siblings?
Arron held up 6 fingers and pointed to himself.
You have 6 brothers.
He nodded.
Wow, that must have been an interesting experience for your parents.
Arron shook his head and held up 1 finger.
You only have 1 parent.
He nodded and then pointed to her.
A mother?
He nodded again.
Your mother raised 7 boys by herself? Well, she has my utmost respect. I don't know if I could handle raising 1 boy alone, much less 7.
Arron felt another stab of guilt. Now that she'd said that, perhaps he'd never truly given his mother enough credit for raising 7 children and ruling a kingdom all by herself. With that in mind, maybe it shouldn't come as much of a surprise that she had such thin patience.
And where are you in line?
He held up 7 fingers.
The youngest, huh? Oof, that must be hard. You're lucky to have siblings, though. I've always wanted a younger brother or sister. And maybe if my parents hadn't...
Arron slowly brought his hand up, hoping he wasn't moving too fast, and lightly touched her shoulder. She gave him a sad smile, and he was glad that she wasn't angry with him for touching her.
I almost died the same way last week. We were almost home, and our ship got caught in a terrible storm. I was lucky to survive. I guess we have that in common.
He wished he could tell her that he had been there before and after the wreck and had been the one to rescue her. He wanted to tell her everything about him, and he wanted to learn even more about her.
I have every reason to fear the ocean, but something about it just keeps pulling me back.
She smiled as she looked out at the water.
My father used to take me out sailing and taught me how to properly run a ship that could weather any storm. Maybe sailing isn't exactly how a princess should be spending her time. But he never seemed to care about things like that. He made sure I completed all of my lessons, of course. That when it came to the more princessy things, he wanted me to spend time doing activities I actually enjoyed. We'd be out on the ocean for days sometimes, and he'd tell me stories about mermaids.
Arron froze, unsure of where she was going with this.
I used to spend hours watching the ocean, both on shore and from my bedroom, or leaning over the railing when we all went on voyages, hoping that I might catch a glimpse of one. I've obviously stopped looking now that I'm older, but there's a part of me that still hopes that they're out there somewhere. I mean, there's so much we don't know about the ocean. Why can't mermaids be part of that?
Arron chuckled soundlessly. Just when he thought he couldn't like Erica more, she spent her time dreaming that merpeople were real. He could only imagine her reaction if he told her where he came from and who he really was. But without proof, she'd never believe him and would think that he was patronizing her.
I'm sorry, this probably sounds so childish.
Arron shook his head as he smiled. It was more endearing than she could possibly know.
You know, you're the first person in a while who's ever really listened to me. Maybe that's unfair to say since you don't really have a choice.
If he did have a choice, he would happily listen to her talk as much as she wanted. He loved listening to her beautiful voice.
I wish she had a better way to talk than writing things down and pantomiming. That must be so tiresome. I have an idea. Come with me.
She took his hand and led him back to the palace and through the hallways, clearly looking for someone in particular. Finally, they saw a young maid, probably only a little older than Arron himself, carrying a set of sheets towards one of the bedrooms. Erica approached her and gently tapped her on the shoulder. Arron didn't know why she didn't just call her name, but maybe that was considered rude for a princess to do. The young woman turned and politely curtsied. To Aaron's surprise, Erica began moving her hands around as she spoke.
Arron, this is Sarah. She's deaf, which means she can't hear, so we have to communicate using a sign language.
She turned back to the young woman.
Sarah, this is Arron. He can't speak. Do you think you could teach him a few signs so he can communicate a little better with me and the rest of the staff?
Sarah eagerly nodded. She handed the sheets to the princess, which seemed improper, but then Arron realized that freeing her hands was the only way she would be able to respond. Arron watched her hands create various movements at a dizzying speed.
She said that it's nice to meet you, and she would be happy to teach you.
Of all the things Arron knew about humans, he never could have imagined that some of them talked to each other using their hands. Sarah took the sheets back from the princess.
I'm going to go ahead and prepare for tomorrow,
Erica told Arron, still signing so that Sarah could understand her.
I'll let you two get acquainted. Sarah, could you show Arron to the room that you prepared for him? You can have a lesson or two in there if you'd like.
Sarah curtsied again.
In that case, I'll see you tomorrow, Arron. Good night.
Arron politely bowed at the waist. He at least knew that was something that was appropriate for royalty both on land and underwater. Apollo and Atticus swam into the throne room.
Is there any sign of him?
I'm sorry, Mother. We've looked everywhere.
He didn't just disappear off the face of the earth. He's got to be somewhere.
It's not just him. No one's seen Serena or Angel either.
Serena wouldn't just disappear with no warning. And Arron stayed away before, but never this long. He's always come home. Something has to be wrong.
The four other princes swam up next to Apollo and Atticus.
Anything?
No. I'm sorry.
Well, he has to be somewhere. Search everywhere. Leave no shell unturned. Do you understand? No one is to sleep until we know he is safe.
The six princes bowed.
Yes, Mother.
As they all swam off to continue searching for their youngest brother, Athena resumed sitting in her throne and lightly grasped her trident in her hands. Then she softly began to weep.
My baby. I'm so sorry. Please come back home.
Athena would never forgive herself if something happened to her precious little boy, all because she hadn't listened to his side of things. She couldn't fault Arron for not fully understanding her hatred of humankind when he had been too young to remember his father and what had happened to him. If only she'd tried to hear him out instead of insisting that her way was the only way. All she'd ever done was push him further and further away, and now it may be too late to ever get him back. She softly began to sing her lullaby, as if it might help call him home.
Where the north wind meets the sea, there's a mother full of memory. Come, my darling, homeward bound. When all is lost, then all.
Chapter 7. Out in the Town. Early the next morning, Erica walked out to the courtyard where a carriage was awaiting its two passengers.
Good morning, Louis.
She called to the footman who was feeding the horse attached to the carriage.
Ah, good morning, Princess. I'm glad to see you getting out of the palace to somewhere that's not a ship.
How can I help it if the ocean is just a perfect place to spend a day or two or seven?
And you're being escorted by such a handsome fellow as well. You'll be the envy of every young woman in town.
Oh, come on, Arron is only a friend.
Well, here's your friend now.
The girl turned and watched Arron walk into the courtyard. He had dressed in dark blue pants, a white shirt, and a sleeveless black vest. She could feel another blush rising to her cheeks that she quickly willed away.
Good morning, Arron.
Good morning, Princess Erica.
He replied in the signed language.
I see that you've picked up some signs.
She began to move her hands as she spoke, so that he could continue to learn a sign here and there.
How late did you and Sarah stay up last night?
Late.
Well, then I hope you won't be too tired for a day out.
Arron shook his head as he smiled. His signing was slow and clumsy, and he didn't have a very extensive vocabulary. But at least he had a better way to really talk to Erica now, and she seemed to be able to understand what he was trying to get across. While learning with Sarah last night, he had noticed that she used a lot of facial expressions when signing, and he guessed that one's expressions were a further way of communicating the inflection of the sign, so he attempted to do the same now. It felt a little strange and uncomfortable to be so silently expressive, but if facial expressions were important to the sign language, then he would use them. Especially if it showed his appreciation for the new way to communicate.
Well, let's not waste any more daylight.
Arron quickly went up to the carriage and held his hand out so that he could help Erica inside. After a good night's sleep, his legs were thankfully much stronger, and there was no danger of them giving out on him again.
Oh, thank you, sir.
Once she was seated, Arron pulled himself inside.
Everyone ready?
Ready.
Then off we go.
Arron felt his stomach lurch as the carriage took off. He looked over the side and was stunned that something could pull them across the land so quickly. He pointed to the animal leading the carriage.
This is the sign for horse,
Erica said as she moved her hand, assuming he wanted to know the sign rather than what the thing actually was. This would work out rather well for him. This way, he could ask about all of the many wonderful things around them, and Erica would never know that he was completely clueless about almost everything in her world. Well, at least no more than she probably already assumed after the whole debacle with the fork at dinner yesterday. When the carriage tumbled across a bridge, Angel smiled as she swam alongside it in the water below.
Has she kissed him yet?
Not yet,
Serena whispered back from inside the carriage. Angel groaned in frustration. But on the bright side, her best friend still had 2 whole days left. That would be plenty of time for the princess to fall in love with him. How could she not? The carriage rolled right into the middle of a busy square with all kinds of different people going about their day, as if it wasn't one of the most important days of Arron's life. Once Louis stopped the carriage, Arron quickly climbed out first and then helped Erica out as well.
Enjoy your day, Princess. I'll be waiting right here for you both when you're ready to return to the palace.
Thank you, Louis. Please feel free to enjoy yourself today as well.
She turned to face Arron.
Where would you like to go first?
Arron looked around him at the various stalls and shops. There was so much to see that he had no idea where to start. He rushed over to a stall selling hundreds of different types of flowers. The whole stall smelled so fresh and beautiful. He hadn't known that so many kinds of flowers existed, all of them unique and vibrantly colored. He wished he could just take all of them, but even he knew that was a ridiculous idea.
See this one here?
Erica said as she pointed to a purple one.
It's called a violet, and this one is a lily.
They're so pretty.
Nothing brightens up a room quite like a pretty flower.
She handed the woman behind the cart some coins and picked out a purple iris. Then she gently pinned it on the front of Arron's vest.
Or it can brighten up someone's clothing.
I love it.
She then noticed that he was still wearing the purple shell necklace.
This is really unique. Where did you get it?
I don't remember.
He thought he could recall his mother mentioning to him that it had been a birthday gift from his father. But of course, he wouldn't remember that. Everyone remembered King Triton as a great warrior and a stern king, and Arron had heard enough stories from his brothers to know that those titles were well earned. But wearing the shell made him think that Triton must have also been a loving father to his seven sons, and knew what they wanted before they knew themselves. Arron wished that he could remember him.
Well, it suits you.
Thank you.
For the next few hours, Arron and Erica walked around the town, occasionally stopping inside a shop or in front of a stall. One of the stores happened to be an antique shop, full of various items from at least 50 years ago or longer. Erica warned him that everything was very old and expensive, and that he had to be careful around the items inside. Arron was amazed at all of the human treasures that he had never seen before, despite previously owning hundreds of human objects. The place somewhat reminded him of his old grotto, and he felt a sliver of anger burn inside him as he recalled what had happened to it. But he quickly smothered the feeling since it had at least brought him to Erica. He couldn't imagine how long it must have taken the owner to collect all of these treasures. As much as he wanted to carefully examine every single object in the store, he was too worried that he might accidentally break something if he touched any of it, and he knew how it would feel to lose even one of these treasures. Seeing Arron's excitement and curiosity, the kind owner patiently explained what several items were and their uses, and Arron soaked in all of the information, never able to get enough of it. Erica remained thoroughly charmed at Aaron's childlike excitement. Later on, they went to one of the food stalls and had some sausages and warm bread for lunch, along with some sugar cookies. Some performers came out to the middle of the square and began doing elaborate stunts for the passing crowds. Arron watched in amazement as one of them lit three sticks on fire and then tossed them in the air from one hand to the other.
How does he not hurt himself?
He probably has. I'm sure he's had to practice for many, many hours to be able to do that so well.
Another performer twisted and turned her body into such awkward and tight positions that Arron felt his own muscles get sore just watching her. After a couple more acts, the performers left and were replaced by a small band consisting of a violin, a harp, a flute, and a cello. It didn't take long for people to begin dancing around the square to the beautiful music.
Arron, would you like to dance with me?
Arron quickly shook his head. As much as he had always wanted to know what it was like to dance with two legs, he had just mastered walking about 12 hours ago. He didn't need to try something else just yet.
I can't dance.
It's easy. Come on, I'll teach you.
Arron looked at the other dancing couples. He supposed it didn't look too difficult, and from what he could tell as he watched them, Erica was offering to let him hold her in his arms. How could he turn that down? Erica smiled as she took his hand and led him over to the makeshift dance floor.
Okay, so you put your right hand here on my waist,
she instructed as she guided his hand to the small of her back. Arron felt his face warm again.
And then your other hand holds mine out like this. And now you just listen to the music and step with the beat.
She carefully moved them both in small circles around the area.
See? Easy, right?
Maybe it was easy for her, but Arron found it difficult to know where his feet were supposed to go and when, and he was terrified that he was going to accidentally step on her toes. But after a few minutes, he soon got the hang of moving around in time with the instruments.
And if you want to switch things up, you can spin me like this.
She slowly helped him spin her around, and then comfortably settled back into his arms. Arron watched another one of the men dip his partner. He quickly took note of where the couple's arms were and how the man pulled the woman back up and slipped back into the normal rhythm. Arron hoped that he could trust his strong arms to support Erica where his legs had failed yesterday. Carefully, he imitated the other couple and slowly dipped her. Erica blushed as she met his crystal blue eyes.
Wow. You catch on quickly.
Arron gently pulled her back up as the song came to a close. Musical notes were beginning to swell inside of him in the excitement of the moment, but he realized that he now had no way of ridding himself of them. It was uncomfortably stifling, and he decided that he needed to figure out some way to expel the music inside of him without a voice to do it. He glanced at one of the shops they hadn't yet visited, and then looked through the window with curiosity.
And that's a music store. They sell all kinds of instruments like the ones the band members were playing right now. Can you play anything?
Arron walked into the store and looked around. Coming from a musical family, all of the princes had learned how to play an instrument when they were young. After they turned 16, they could decide if they wanted to continue the lessons or focus on their other royal duties. Arron didn't know if the instrument he'd learned to play underwater had an equal counterpart on land, but then there in the corner, he spotted a very large instrument that looked strikingly similar to the instrument he had studied, unwillingly, for about 10 years.
Do you play piano?
Oh, so it was called a piano. Arron ran his hand along the black and white keys and pressed down on some of them to release a beautiful musical sound that was even more melodic in the shop than it had ever sounded in the ocean. He took a seat on the bench and softly began to play a sequence of repeating notes with his right hand, while adding some chords here and there with his left hand. It took him a second to adjust to the differences between this instrument and the one he was used to, but he was pleased to find that the general idea of it remained the same. Erica smiled and listened as Arron played a beautiful song on the piano that she had never heard before. It started out on the far right side, but then he moved down two octaves and played a repeating melody, gradually adding more chords the more it repeated. She slowly took a seat next to him on the piano bench. When he came to a point where he paused in the song, Erica put her hands to the keys and repeated a sequence of several chords on the far left end of the piano in a faster tempo. Arron looked at her in surprise before smiling at her. Then he repeated the melody again with her new chords to back it up and matched her new tempo. The addition fit perfectly with the original song he had learned as a child and brought to it a new life that he hadn't realized it needed. As they played the song together, Arron felt the buildup of notes in his chest release themselves with the piano keys. Erica played a few slower chords, which gave Arron room to end the song. When he lifted his fingers from the keys, Erica laughed lightly.
So you do play piano.
So do you.
I learned, but I didn't think I would ever actually enjoy it.
Me neither.
Well, the day's almost over. Is there anything else that you want to do before we go back to the palace?
Arron's stomach clenched. How was his second day almost over already? There had to be something the both of them could do that would allow them to spend just a few more hours together. Not only was he not ready for the best day of his life to come to a close, but after this, he only had one more day to earn a kiss from Erica. And who knew if the opportunity would present itself tomorrow?
If you're up for it, there's a beautiful lake nearby with some rowboats for people to use. We could go out onto the water for a little while. It's especially pretty at night with the moon out.
It was like she knew exactly what he needed.
That's perfect.
I'll get Lewis to bring the carriage around.
She left his side to find their footmen, and Arron smiled broadly. Surely this moment would help lead to a kiss. He would win this deal easily.
Young man?
A voice called from one of the stalls. Arron turned and approached the flower stall they had stopped at when they'd first arrived at the square.
Take this.
The owner smiled as she handed him a red rose.
For your beautiful young lady. In the language of flowers, it means love.
Arron gestured to his pockets to show that he didn't have any way to pay for it.
Oh no, free of charge. Make sure you hold on to that girl. She's a special one.
Arron smiled and signed a thank you, hoping that even if she didn't know the signed language, she would be able to guess his meaning. He had every intention of holding on to Erica. He would do anything to let her know how much she truly meant to him. When Erica returned, Arron presented her with the rose. Erica blushed as she took it from him.
Oh, thank you. It's beautiful.
Arron looked over at the owner of the flower stall, and the woman winked at him. The carriage soon came rumbling towards them, and Arron helped Erica inside before climbing in himself. Then Lewis led the carriage down to the lake, and Arron saw that with the moon brightly reflecting on the water and lighting up the plants, trees, fish, and animals all living together in the area, it was an even more perfect setting to share a kiss than he had pictured.
Shall I row you, my lady? Or would you prefer to be alone?
I think we can manage, right, Arron?
Arron nodded. He wasn't sure if he'd be able to gracefully row a boat, but he'd rather not have Lewis in the boat with them while he tried to create a perfect moment for a kiss.
Very well, then. I'll wait here for you. Take all the time you'd like.
The attendant at the dock helped Erica and Arron get a small rowboat into the water before helping each of them into it. Then he handed them both two oars and told them to be careful out in the water.
All right. How about you take one oar and I'll take the other?
I can just take both.
No, that just feels wrong. I can't let you do all the work.
Since Arron didn't know anything about rowing a boat, he decided that sharing the load might not be such a bad idea. Erica sat in the front while Arron took the back, and together they paddled the rowboat across the water. It took some effort to figure out how to steer, but soon enough they were able to settle into a peaceful rhythm. Neither of them spoke, and while Arron wanted to talk to her in his very limited time with her, he also appreciated her desire to listen to the music of nature for a while. Crickets chirped, frogs croaked, owls hooted, and water splashed. Arron had never heard such a beautiful symphony of sounds together before, and he could have easily stayed out on the water all night just listening to it all. Erica stopped paddling and tucked her oar into one of the boat's holders. Then she carefully turned around so she could face Arron. Arron put his oar into the other holder as well, and the boat began to slowly amble down the lake. To Aaron's embarrassment, they could suddenly hear a bird squawking, and he immediately pegged it as Scuttle's attempt at making music.
Oh my, do you think that poor bird is injured?
Arron put his hand to his mouth to stifle his laughter. Still a little bitter about Scuttle's incorrect knowledge about human tools, he didn't really mind the unintentional joke at her expense. Serena and Angel swam up next to the boat out of Erica's sight, and Arron sent them a pleading look to make the horrible noise stop. The small crab and the striped fish gladly accepted the silent plea. After silencing the foolish seagull, Serena used her powers of orchestration to create a perfect ambiance for the two passengers, with the crickets, birds, and various vegetation around the area. The rowboat floated beneath a weeping willow, which gave them a place especially for the two of them. A place perfect for sharing a romantic kiss.
This is beautiful.
This was my mother and father's favorite place. They were in an arranged marriage, but I'm certain that even if they weren't, they still would have married. I've never seen two people more in love. They used to come here all the time when they needed just a few minutes to themselves. And then after I was born, they brought me with them, and it became my favorite place, too. Being out on a ship in the ocean is where I feel the most comfortable, but it's also an escape. This place is where I can face my problems and clear my head. It's where I feel them again.
They sound like amazing parents. You must miss them a lot.
If it wasn't for Grimhilda and some of the other servants, I don't know if I ever would have been able to move on.
It's nice that you have such a great relationship with your staff.
Back in Atlantica, Arron knew that some of the members of the royal family, namely Adonis, didn't always treat their servants very well, and he had always wondered if human royalty acted the same.
It wasn't always that way. When I was younger, some princesses from the neighboring kingdoms visited the palace. We were taking tea in the gardens, and the other princesses started complaining about their servants. In order to fit in with them, I did too. Suffice it to say that my mother and father were not happy when they found out. And as punishment, they had me live and work as a servant for an entire week so that I could understand what they went through every day and appreciate what they do for me. Some people might say that was cruel of them, but I think it was one of the best things they ever did for me. That experience allowed me to befriend the servants and see them as equals instead of people beneath me. All of them were there for me when my parents died, and I can't imagine enduring that loss without their support.
It's sad to think those other princesses don't have those kinds of relationships.
I'm impressed with how quickly you've picked up sign language.
Truthfully, Arron was a very quick learner. If he really put his mind to it, he could master almost any subject in a few months. The problem was that Arron could never focus long enough to actually study anything, even something he enjoyed. Whenever he tried to learn something, all he could think about was his treasure trove of human objects and where he could go next to find another one. Searching for human stuff had usually been the only thing that could capture his full attention.
It was kind of you to hire Sarah.
Arron had never met someone who was deaf, but he imagined that not being able to hear anything would make it difficult for her to find work. Erica gave him an embarrassed look.
Not to keep tainting your high opinion of me, but I was actually one of the people who was against hiring her when she first arrived looking for work. But some of the other servants convinced me to give her a chance. And now, 3 years later, she's one of the best servants we've ever had in the palace. I learned that I should judge people by what they can do, not by what they can't. I had all of the palace staff learn how to communicate with her. And then I learned the sign language myself, because I never wanted her to feel like she didn't have a voice in my palace. And I want you to know that the same goes for you. Even if you can't speak, please don't feel like you don't have a voice.
You and Sarah have given me a way to communicate, which is more than I ever could have asked for.
You have my word that Sarah and I will teach you more and more signs every day, so that you will never be without a way to talk. I want to know everything you have to say.
Arron smiled kindly at her. With the moon shining down onto her black hair, she looked especially beautiful and angelic, and he didn't think it was possible for him to love her more. He gently tucked a loose strand of hair behind her ear, which made her cheeks redden. Then he nervously began to move closer to her, afraid that she would pull back. Even if his freedom wasn't riding on this kiss, he would never want to force her to do something she wasn't comfortable with. But to his delight, Erica began moving closer to him as well. Her eyes closed, and so did his. An inch away, a centimeter away, and then the boat tipped over and Arron and Erica fell into the water. Fortunately, the water was only about knee-deep, but both of them still became completely drenched. Erica wiped her eyes and moved her wet hair out of her face as she coughed.
Are you all right?
Arron nodded as he helped her stand up. He'd been so close. He'd been extremely close. So close that there was no way that the boat tipping over was some random accident. With a growing sense of dread, Arron realized that there was only one creature who stood to lose something if Arron earned a kiss from the princess. And if the sorcerer was willing to interfere with Aaron's deal, how many other merfolk had he cheated out of their own deals to ensure that he was the victor? Arron helped Erica flip the boat back over, and they carefully managed to climb back inside. Erica blushed yet again when she realized that Aaron's blue shirt now clung tightly to his body and accented each muscle on both of his arms. And then she realized that she probably looked the same way in her white shirt and nervously cleared her throat as she covered her chest with her arms. Arron noticed that Erica looked uncomfortable and scared, like she thought he might hurt her. Quickly understanding the problem, he took off his black vest and carefully draped it around her shoulders. Erica smiled gratefully as she put the vest over her white shirt.
Thank you. Let's head back to the palace and get into some dry clothes.
Arron sighed heavily. He couldn't let this bring him down. He still had one more day, so he just had to make sure he found a way to earn a kiss from Erica tomorrow, and stay away from water at all costs. Ursulus watched the whole interaction from his glowing orb, hot fury boiling inside him. He was just lucky that his eels had gotten to the boat and flipped it in time, or all of his careful planning would have been for nothing, and he would be right back where he started.
That was a close one. Too close. That little brat. How was I to know the humans have an entire language that uses their hands? I should have taken those from him as well. At this rate, she'll be kissing him by tomorrow's sunset for sure!
He angrily swam over to the cabinet that housed all of his ingredients for potions, and threw several of them into his cauldron, which made his lair begin to glow an angry and eerie yellow.
It's time Ursulus took matters into his own tentacles.
He tossed one more ingredient into the cauldron, which exploded on contact and began to fill the lair with smoke.
Athena's son will be mine, and then I'll make that wretched queen regret ever banishing me. I'll watch her suffer for the rest of her miserable life. I'll see her wriggle like a worm on a hook.
Ursulus clutched the same nautilus shell that contained Arron's voice and began cackling madly, which echoed all throughout the lair. Then his white hair darkened, his tentacles disappeared, and his mad cackle transformed into something no creature of land or sea had ever heard before. The smooth, evil laugh of a young merprince. Chapter 8. Deadly Interference. Erica stood out on the balcony of her bedroom, once again humming the song she'd heard from the mysterious stranger who'd saved her life. She knew it had only been about a week, but she was beginning to lose hope that she'd ever find him. But another part of her wondered if it was better that she hadn't. To her shock, she'd almost kissed Arron earlier. Normally, Erica didn't give her heart away so easily. But when it came to Arron, there was something so pure and beautiful about him that she'd never seen in any other man before. Erica stared out at the ocean and wished that she could dive inside and swim away for just a moment's peace. Things seemed to make more sense when she was out at sea. It was moments like these where she felt the loss of her mother especially hard. The queen had always seemed to have the right answer to any dilemma Erica faced.
My lady, it's getting late,
Grimhilda said gently as she joined her on the balcony.
You should be in bed by now.
I know. I don't know how I'm going to be able to fall asleep, though.
And why would that be? Perhaps a certain attractive redhead is consuming your thoughts.
Erica's face warmed as she recalled how the night had ended. After they'd returned to the palace, Arron and Erica had bathed and changed into warm clothes. Then the both of them sat in front of the fire, drinking some soothing hot chocolate. She could have sat there with him forever. But unfortunately, Grimhilda and Carlyle had entered the room, stating that they both needed to get to bed and could spend as much time together as they desired tomorrow.
Today was amazing. I can't even remember the last time I had so much fun somewhere that wasn't the ocean. But at the same time, something about it all feels wrong. Like I've already given my heart to someone else, and here I am entertaining thoughts about him instead.
My dear, we've looked as hard as we could, and no one has revealed themselves to be the one you're searching for. So, my question for you is, are you going to spend the rest of your life searching for someone you don't know anything about, and who you may never find? Or will you accept someone who is already here, and quite obviously adores you? And, if I may be so bold, I believe the feeling is mutual.
Erica looked up at the window of Arron's room, recalling last night when she'd been down in the garden with Maxine and had looked up to find him out on the balcony watching her. Realizing he'd been caught, he'd given her an awkward smile and wave before disappearing back into the bedroom.
I'm never going to know who he is, am I?
I don't believe so. Maybe it's for the best.
Erica knew that she would always remain curious about her mysterious savior, but she couldn't deny her strong attraction to Arron and how safe she felt around him, and how his innocence and naivete about the world around him was like a breath of fresh air when compared to all of the suitors she'd been forced to entertain in the recent years.
All this time, I've never even asked him where he's from. What if he has a life that he needs to go back to? What if we're just fooling ourselves?
You've only known him for 2 days. You still have plenty of time to get to know one another. It's not like there's a deadline hanging over your heads and you have to know everything about him in a week.
I suppose. I'll be in a minute.
Don't stay up too late, Your Highness.
Grimhilda stepped back inside the bedroom and disappeared into the hallway. Erica leaned back against the balcony as she sighed. Maybe it was indeed time to give up ever finding her rescuer. There was no telling if there would even be any sort of attraction between them anyway if she did find him. Maybe he had just seen someone in trouble, helped her, and that was the end of it. For all she knew, she was remembering some of the events wrong, and the person wasn't at all like she believed. It was difficult having to give up her pursuit, but she decided that Arron was more important and more real than this unreliable memory. Come the morning, she would discuss more about his home and family and find out what their possible future together held. Erica was just about to step back into her bedroom when she heard faint singing. She frantically turned back around and peered over the balcony. She dared not hope that it was truly her rescuer, but she was sure that voice was the one that had been stuck inside her head since the moment she'd first heard it. She looked down and tried to see if she could make out its owner, but the fog rolling in from the ocean was too thick to see anything clearly. Someone slowly walked along the beach, beautiful and smooth notes leaving his throat and wrapping around her like a warm blanket. Erica could somewhat make out a handsome young man dressed in a dark purple shirt and black pants, with a blue cloak waving behind him in the ocean breeze. A nautilus shell glowed around his neck, and when Erica stared at it, the same yellowish hue filled her eyes. Her face slackened as every thought inside her mind slowly and completely faded away. Down on the beach, the one calling himself Varian smirked as he felt some of the magic inside him take effect on the dear little princess.
Arron!
A loud voice called outside his window. Arron drowsily sat up as Scuttle flew into his bedroom and landed on the bed.
Arron! I just heard the news! Congratulations, kiddo! We did it!
We did what?
Arron signed on instinct, forgetting that his animal companions weren't familiar with the language. Serena put her claws to her aching head.
What are you going on about?
Oh, as if you two didn't know! The whole town's buzzing about the princess getting hitched this afternoon!
Arron's brow furrowed.
I mean, she's getting married!
The clarification did nothing to help his confusion. Why would Erica be getting married so suddenly, and more importantly, to whom? Because she certainly hadn't discussed the idea of marriage with him, and he was fairly confident that there wasn't anyone else in the picture.
I just wanted to wish you luck. I'll catch you later at the wedding. I wouldn't miss it.
As Scuttle excitedly flew back out of the window, Arron turned to Serena, still just as clueless as before.
That's about how I feel whenever that mindless bird says anything. Come on, we should go see what this is about.
Arron quickly dressed and made his way downstairs. Everyone he passed seemed to be giving him strange glances like they felt sorry for him. He understood that he couldn't speak, but having someone with one of their senses missing was nothing new for the palace servants. But when Arron got to the main ballroom, everything quickly became clear, and his heart seemed to shatter into 1,000 pieces.
Well, my dear, it appears your search proved worthwhile. You managed to find the mystery savior of yours after all. And he's, quite a vision.
Around Erica's shoulders draped the arm of a very handsome man in a navy blue suit with jet black hair. A man who wore a very familiar nautilus shell around his neck. Arron felt ill. Sabotaging his evening with Erica hadn't been enough. The sorcerer had decided that intervention on land had become necessary to keep him from winning their deal. Arron quickly hid behind a pillar before any of them saw him. He couldn't think straight. He could barely even breathe. He felt like he'd been stung by 1,000 different jellyfish, and their poison was coursing through his veins.
But Princess, what about...
Never mind that. Varian and I wish to be married as soon as possible.
Are you quite sure about that? Don't you want even a little time to get to know each other more?
No.
Well, all right, but these things take time and...
This afternoon, Grimhilda.
This afternoon? Princess, I...
The wedding ship departs at sunset.
Princess!
You have your orders, Grimhilda.
The elder woman sighed heavily and then politely bowed her head.
As you wish, Princess.
That evening, Arron dejectedly watched the large wedding ship carrying Princess Erica, the sorcerer disguised as a human, several palace servants, nobles, and townspeople, depart from the dock. He wished that Sarah wasn't one of those people on the boat. Right now, she was about the only person he'd be comfortable communicating with. He remembered going to bed last night, excited to show her everything he'd learned that day. But with the announcement that Erica wanted a last-minute wedding, none of the staff had had time to speak with him. Maybe that was for the best anyway, considering how all of them had just stared at him with pity, which he'd had just about enough of. Angel appeared in the water below and looked up at her best friend sadly. Arron sank down onto the edge of the dock and let his bare feet touch the water. The harsh reality of his situation had finally sunken in. In just a few hours, the sorcerer was going to win their deal. and he would be turned into one of those slimy polyps, doomed to wither in the entranceway of that horrible lair for the rest of his life. Arron didn't think it was unmanly of him to admit that he was terrified, and that more than ever before, he wished that his mother was here. He wanted her to sing him her lullaby and stroke his hair like she always did when he had trouble falling asleep. He even missed all of his brother's teasing and jests and would have traded anything to have any one of them here right now, even Adonis. Now that he was faced with the prospect of never seeing his family again, he realized just how much he had never truly appreciated his relationships with his mother and brothers. He just wanted someone to tell him that things would be okay. Something wet ran down Aaron's cheek. He cautiously put his hand up and wiped away the water on his face, and then looked at Serena in confusion.
They are called tears, dear. They appear when humans are sad. You've probably had them come before, and just never knew it since you were underwater.
He looked at her curiously, wondering how she knew that and he didn't.
I may know a thing or two about humans.
Arron gently rubbed his finger over Serena's head. Even if she'd disagreed with his decision, she'd stayed by his side all this time and helped him attempt to win over the princess. And he wished he could tell her how much he appreciated it, while maybe teasing her a little and calling her Siri. On any other day, Serena might have pinched Arron for patronizing her size, but she decided that just this once she would indulge the heartbroken prince. Meanwhile, Scuttle was just flying by the boat where the wedding was taking place when she heard something very strange coming from one of the portholes. Someone was singing, and it sounded a lot like Arron. But that couldn't be possible because Arron had given up his voice for his legs. She quickly flew over to an open porthole for a better look. Inside, she could see the princess's attractive future groom flouncing around the cabin, half-dressed.
What a lovely little bride she'll make, my dear, you'll look divine. Things are working out according to my ultimate design. Soon I'll have that little merman and the ocean will be mine.
Scuttle watched in horror as a young man pulled up the mirror on the vanity, and the reflection looking back was that of the sea sorcerer. Arron's smooth voice mixed together with his rough cackle, which sent a shiver down the seagull's feathers.
The sea sorcerer? He's... I gotta...
Scuttle quickly flew away from the boat and directly to the dock by the palace.
Arron! Arron!
Arron looked up as the bird urgently sat down next to him.
I was flying? Well, of course I was flying, and I saw the groom, only he wasn't the groom. I saw the sorcerer watching a mirror. He was singing with a stolen set of pipes. Do you hear what I'm telling you? The princess is marrying the sea sorcerer in disguise.
Arron looked at the bird helplessly. He had already guessed as much, and he wasn't sure if there was anything to be done about it now. As much as it pained him to admit, he was just no match for Ursulus.
What are we gonna do?
Angel asked worriedly from down in the water.
We have to do something, right, Arron? I mean, you can't just let her marry Ursulus.
Arron looked out at the sunset as a sorcerer's words confirming their deal echoed in his head.
Before the sun sets on the third day.
No. What was he thinking? He had wasted all this time wallowing in self-pity when he could have been coming up with a plan. Arron felt a deep and fiery anger completely overshadow any of his misery. The sorcerer may have intentionally messed up their agreement in the worst ways possible, but the third day wasn't over yet. He wasn't about to just sit back and watch the girl he loved marry someone like Ursulus without fighting back. Erica had told him that even though he didn't speak, he had a voice, and gosh darn it, he was going to use it. He looked down at Serena with determination in his eyes. The little crab understood immediately. She snapped a rope tying several barrels together, and they all fell into the ocean.
Arron, grab onto one of those.
Arron dove into the water and quickly latched himself onto the nearest barrel.
Angel, get him to that boat as fast as your fins can carry you.
Angel put the rope on the barrel around her body.
Got it!
I've got to get to the queen. She must know about this.
What about me? What about me?
Find a way to stall that wedding. Do whatever you have to do in order to make sure that the princess absolutely does not marry the sorcerer.
Stall the wedding.
Oh, I can do that.
She quickly flew off with loud squawks and calls that alerted every creature of air and sea of their dire predicament.
Don't worry, Arron!
Angel panted as she frantically tried to pull him towards the ship.
We're gonna make it! I won't let you down!
On board the ship, Varian and Erica walked down a small makeshift aisle, and everyone politely bowed to the princess as she passed by them. Maxine growled at the foreign human, who most certainly was not who her mistress should be marrying. Varian lightly kicked the dog to quiet it. He didn't need any sort of complications from the stupid animal. Only a few more minutes, and the sun would set, and the merprince was as good as dead. The couple arrived at the end of the aisle in front of an altar.
Dearly beloved, we are gathered here today to join together two souls in holy matrimony.
Varian rolled his eyes. There wasn't anyone who could speak any faster. Well, soon it wouldn't matter anyway. He smiled as the sun set further and further on the most important day of the young prince's painfully short life.
Yes, do you, Erica, take Varian to be your lawfully wedded husband for as long as you both shall live?
Erica stared blankly ahead of her.
I do.
The sound of horrendous caws and squawks drowned out the priest's next words. Varian looked up and managed to duck just as a swarm of bluebirds swooped over his head. Seagulls and pelicans flew all over the ship, and two seals jumped on board, which sent the passengers screaming and trying to find places to hide. Varian cursed under his breath. No doubt this was that stupid merman's doing. It didn't matter. He was too late. The princess was still under his spell, and there wouldn't be enough time to break it and kiss her before the sun set. His train of thought was interrupted when three pelicans flew over him and doused him with ocean water. Ugh. The last batch also contained several crabs, and one of them decided to tightly pinch Varian's nose. Ugh. With a furious cry, Varian ripped the crab off his face. While the animals did their best to distract the sorcerer, Angel finally made it to the side of the ship, breathing heavily from the exertion of the swim. Arron smiled gratefully at her, and then carefully climbed up the side of the ship to the upper deck. When his head peeked over the railing, the first person to see him was none other than Sarah. Her eyes widened, and she quickly came over to him to help him onto the deck. She frantically moved her hands to ask him what he was doing. If Arron wasn't so pressed for time, he would have gotten quite a kick out of watching so many creatures abusing the sorcerer in several very painful and very humiliating ways. Two seals tossed Ursulus as Varian into the giant wedding cake, and Arron quickly pulled Sarah out of the path of some of the flying pieces. Sarah signed her thanks and then told him that the princess wasn't herself, because when she had tried to talk to her earlier about some wedding arrangements, Erica hadn't attempted to communicate with her at all. Not only that, but the mysterious man who claimed to be Erica's savior hadn't left her side all day and had barely allowed her to even speak. She didn't know who the strange man was, but she didn't like him.
Believe me, I don't either. I need to talk to Erica, quickly. I don't have a lot of time.
Sarah didn't know what he meant by that, but she pointed to the princess who was dressed in a terribly gaudy wedding dress, standing at the altar in front of a clueless priest, both of them completely oblivious to the chaos around them. While Scuttle tried to pull the nautilus shell off Ursulus as Varian's neck, Maxine eagerly broke free of her leash and wasted no time in running over to the imposter. Then she chomped on his leg as hard as she could as payback for the kick to the face. Varian cried out in pain, which allowed Scuttle to finally break the cord holding the nautilus shell. The shell flew across the ship and shattered right at Arron's feet. A yellow mist slowly pulled itself up into the air, searching for its rightful owner. Erica's eyes cleared of their yellow hue, and she looked around her as she tried to process how she'd gotten onto a wedding ship that was already in the middle of the ocean. Her eyes landed on Arron, and she heard the voice from last night come from the strange yellow mist floating up from a broken nautilus shell. Arron allowed the mist to wrap around him and enter his throat. Then, for the first time in 3 days, musical notes left his own vocal cords, and he finally felt complete again.
For in this river all is found.
Arron?
Erica.
Erica's heart thumped in her chest as her name left his lips.
You can talk. All this time, it was always you, wasn't it? The one I've been looking for.
Erica,
Get away from him!
Ursulus, as Varian called from the altar, looking a little worse for wear after all the animal abuse he'd been put through. He quickly put his hand over his mouth when the voice that left his lips did not have its usual musical quality.
How is this possible?
I wanted to tell you.
Arron took her into his arms and drew towards her.
Erica, no!
Just before Arron could kiss Erica, he felt a deep and sharp pain in his legs as they quickly fused together, and he sank down to the deck with a cry of pain.
Ah!
The transformation wasn't nearly as bad as the last one, but it was still far from pleasant, and it took several seconds for him to understand what had happened.
Arron, what is it? Are you hurt? What?
She stopped speaking, and her breath caught when she looked at him. Instead of two legs, Arron had a scaly green tail.
Erica, I...
You're too late! You're too late!
Ursulus laughed maniacally as his clothing tore away to reveal white hair, purple skin, and 8 thick black tentacles. With frightening glee, he crawled down the ship and snatched Aaron's wrist. Arron tried to pull away, but the sorcerer's grip was too strong. Ursulus smiled at Erica.
So long, sweet cheeks.
He winked and blew her a kiss with 2 fingers.
It's been fun.
Then he fell into the ocean with his captive. Chapter 9, The Battle.
Your Majesty!
Queen Athena quickly turned around when she heard Serena's desperate cry.
Serena, where have you been? Where's Arron?
Forgive me, Your Majesty, but we don't have a lot of time.
What are you talking about? Where is my son?
He made a deal with the sea sorcerer.
Ursulus? He's still alive?
Yes, but he tricked the prince, and now he's holding him prisoner.
Athena frantically attempted to wrap her head around this new information. Ursulus had always been after the throne, which was exactly why he'd been banished in the first place when Asa was only an infant. She had always warned her children of the sorcerer's betrayal and told them never to speak with him if they somehow came across him. It appeared that all this time, Ursulus had been devising a new plan to steal the throne and her power, and her stubborn son had unknowingly been a key part of it. Athena felt a stab of guilt knowing that she had helped push Arron in this direction. It didn't take much to figure out that he'd gone to Ursulus right after their last argument. Athena gripped her trident in her hand and looked at the crab.
Serena, go fetch the other princes and have them here in no more than 5 minutes.
Erica stood at the railing of the ship, looking down at the water where Arron had disappeared. So many thoughts swirled around her head that she could barely make sense of any of them.
Arron, he's a merman.
I saw it happen, and I'm not sure even I can believe it.
I almost got married to a half-man, half-octopus.
She looked over at Grimhilda.
We will never speak of this again.
Consider it erased from the records.
Erica put her hand to her forehead and stepped away from the railing.
I think I might pass out.
Grimhilda gently took her arm.
Here, sit down for a moment.
No, I need to go after him.
She quickly marched over to the other side of the ship.
Get that longboat ready.
Wait, Princess! We should call for the guards.
By the time we get word to them and they make it out here, assuming they even believe us, Arron could be dead.
And what exactly do you plan to do? Might I remind you, you can't breathe underwater?
I'll figure it out as I go, but I'm not about to just sit here and do nothing. He's saved me twice, and now it's my turn to save him. I am not going to lose him again.
Princess!
Grimhilda! Please, do not make me order you.
Grimhilda stopped speaking as Erica looked at her earnestly. Being very open to the input of others in the palace, be it fellow royalty or the scullery maids, Erica rarely gave direct orders. But when circumstances were dire, she had no choice but to pull rank, even if her decision was a foolish one. Grimhilda could understand how the princess was feeling, and truth be told, she wasn't sure if there was anyone else aboard this ship who might actually be able to help the young man, or apparently merman. As one who knew the ocean better than land, Erica was the only one who stood a chance. The elder woman sighed and turned around.
You heard her. Get the longboat ready to dismount.
Erica smiled gratefully at her. Then she looked down at her large wedding dress.
This is hideous. How could you let me dress in something like this?
We were a bit pressed for time. This was the best we could do.
I'm sorry. I
know it wasn't you. It was, well, whatever that thing was.
Erica turned to face the rest of the passengers.
Does anyone have a knife?
One of the young men quickly approached her and pulled a small dagger out of its sheath on his belt.
Will this do, Princess?
Yes, thank you.
She took the dagger from him, and then to everyone's astonishment, she quickly cut off both arms of her dress before slicing it at the knees. But there was no time to worry about a silly thing like propriety. Right now, Aaron's life was at stake. She looked at the gentleman again and held up the dagger.
Do you mind if I take this?
Do with it as you wish.
Erica quickly went over to the side of the ship and hopped into the lifeboat.
Princess, I must point out that you are the kingdom's sole heir. If something happens...
Erica nodded and removed her ring with the royal seal.
If something happens, I leave the kingdom in your hands. There's no one I trust more to choose my successor.
Grimhilda put her hand to the side of Erica's face.
I love you, my dear.
Erica felt her eyes water, both from the heartfelt confession and from the terror of not knowing what was going to happen in the next few minutes.
I love you too.
Grimhilda took a few steps back, and then, with a heavy heart, she mustered out,
"Lower the longboat."
Poor little prince.
Ursulus crooned as he swam in the direction of his lair with Arron in tow, who was frantically trying to tear himself out of the sorcerer's grasp.
You tricked me. You never planned on letting me keep my legs.
Did you really expect someone who'd been banished for sorcery to play fair? Fear not, little prince. It's not you I'm after. I've a much bigger fish.
Ursulus! Stop!
Aaron's heart panged when he heard his mother's voice. He looked up to see his mother, along with all of his brothers, armed and ready for a fight with Atticus and Avery looking particularly lethal. He couldn't believe that all of them had come for him. After he'd consorted with a known enemy, after he'd broken their laws, after he'd gone up to the surface and become human, they'd still all come to save him.
Why, Queen Athena, how are you?
Let my son go.
Not a chance, Athena. He's mine now.
Ursulus snapped his fingers and procured the contract Arron had signed.
We made a deal.
Athena and the princes looked at Arron with expressions varying between angry, confused, and pitying. The two eels wrapped their tails around Aaron's arms and began to pull him away.
I'm sorry. I didn't.
Athena pointed her trident at Ursulus and blasted the contract. Unfortunately, all she managed to do was send the sorcerer flying backwards. The contract remained intact.
You see? The contract's legal, binding, and completely unbreakable, even for you. But then, I always was someone with an eye for a bargain. The son of the Great Sea Queen is a very precious commodity.
He snapped his fingers again, and yellow magic swirled around Arron. He felt himself begin to shrink down into one of Ursulus's disgusting polyps.
But I might be willing to make an exchange for someone even better.
Athena clenched her jaw as she tightly gripped her trident.
Mother.
Ursulus sultrily glided behind Arron and snapped his fingers to procure a new contract.
So what'll it be, my dear queen? Your crown or your son?
From inside the whirlpool, Arron shook his head. This was his mistake, and he couldn't let his mother pay for it. She was the queen of their kingdom, and they all needed her more than they ever needed him.
You may not believe this, Arron, but I always do whatever it takes to protect my children.
She looked away from her sons and pointed the trident in the direction of the contract so that her signature flashed onto the bottom.
It's done then!
With another horrid snap of the sorcerer's fingers, the yellow magic restored Arron to his normal merman form, then moved over to Athena and swirled around her as she cried out in pain.
Ah!
No!
Athena shrank down to 5 inches and her skin became leathery and shriveled. When the yellow magic dissipated, her crown and trident fell next to her new polyp form. Arron slowly knelt next to her.
Mom?
The polyp looked up at him sadly, and Arron felt a deep, twisting pain in his stomach. How many times had he been so angry at his mother and confident that she could never possibly understand him? And yet, after everything that had happened between them, she'd still willingly sacrifice herself to save him. Ursulus chuckled darkly and took the queen's crown in his hands. Then he put it on top of his head and greedily picked up the glowing trident.
At last, it's mine.
He turned to the other princes with a sadistic grin.
Bow before your new ruler.
Queen Athena is our ruler.
We bow to her, and her alone!
Queen Athena is gone. I said bow!
Using the trident's power, Ursulus enveloped the six merprinces in yellow magic and forced them to drop their weapons and fall into a bow.
You monster!
Arron shot forward and tried to attack the sorcerer. But before he could come within a foot of him, one of the sorcerer's tentacles wrapped around him and threw him against a rock.
I wouldn't do that if I were you, little prince!
Ursulus aimed his trident at Arron, and it began to glow.
I now control the entire ocean! I control everything! Ah!
The sorcerer suddenly cried out in pain when something grazed his arm and drew dark purple blood. Ursulus furiously spun around and saw that the foolish princess had thought it was a smart idea to come after her precious prince and throw a dagger at his captor. Her dress had been cut at the arms and knees, and she looked absolutely livid.
You little tramp!
What are you doing? Get out of here!
Erica quickly began to swim to the surface for air.
After her!
The sorcerer ordered his two pet eels. Erica broke the surface of the water and clutched onto the small longboat she'd used to get all the way out here. But she was only able to take two breaths before she felt two slimy bodies wrap around her and pull her back under. She struggled against her captors, desperate for oxygen, but the two moray eels refused to release their hold on her. What Ursulus had failed to notice was that when Erica had sliced his arm, it had broken his control over the merprinces. Now, free to move again, Asa and Atticus swam over to the eels and simultaneously smacked them with their tails while cutting them down with their daggers. Arden and Apollo fought Ursulus for the trident, but their swords were no match for its power. Arron quickly swam towards Erica and grasped her hand before roughly pulling her up and up until she broke the surface. Taking deep gulps of air, she wiped her eyes and pushed her hair out of her face.
Erica, you need to get away from here!
No, I'm not going to leave you.
You could die!
And so could you!
Please!
Arron!
Erica couldn't finish her sentence because the water began to powerfully churn beneath them, and the very earth trembled with power. Then something rose out of the water, and Erica and Arron felt themselves being lifted above the ocean. It only took a few seconds to realize that the massive object that had come up first was Queen Athena's crown. Ursulus had used the trident's magic to increase his size, so that he was now over 50 feet tall. Arron tightly grasped Erica's hand.
Jump!
The both of them quickly jumped from the giant crown and plunged into the water below. When they resurfaced, Arron pulled Erica close to him as if she would stay alive so long as she was inside his arms.
You pitiful, insignificant fools!
He slammed his tentacles down into the water and created several massive ocean waves. Then he used the trident to conjure up a storm to rile up the ocean even further, all of which effectively separated Arron and Erica.
Arron!
Erica!
Now I am the ruler of all the ocean!
Arron tried furiously to fight the large waves in order to get back to the princess and ensure she didn't drown. But even a creature of the ocean was unable to fight such powerful water. Ursulus put the trident into the water and spun it around to create a large whirlpool.
The waves obey my every whim. The sea and all its spoils bow to my power.
Several previously sunken ships rose to the surface and swirled around the whirlpool. Arron clutched onto a rock and frantically looked around for Erica, but he couldn't find her anywhere. He hoped with everything he had that she wasn't dead. Ursulus turned his sights on him. Then with an evil grin, he blasted the rock Arron was holding, which sent the prince tumbling down inside the whirlpool and completely at the sorcerer's mercy. Every time Erica tried to reach the surface, another powerful wave pushed her back under the water and denied her the precious air her lungs so desperately needed. She briefly wondered why she loved the ocean so much when it just kept taking everything from her. Her vision began to darken, and she could no longer find the strength to keep swimming. She slowly began to sink to the bottom of the ocean. Suddenly, an arm wrapped around her waist and quickly pulled her up to the surface. With ragged gasps and coughs, Erica clutched onto a small piece of flat rock a good distance away from the sea sorcerer's rampage. When she looked up, she saw two other young men in the water waiting for her to catch her breath.
You guys are Aaron's brothers, right?
I'm Adonis, and this is Avery. We haven't got much time. Do you know how to sail?
Yes.
Good. Then you need to sail that.
Erica looked to where he was pointing and saw an old and damaged ship floating precariously in a raging whirlpool. The bow of the ship was cracked and splintered, leaving one particular piece jutting out like a spear.
No, I've never sailed anything that big before by myself. I don't even know if it will sail at all in the state it's in.
You have to. As long as Ursulus has the trident, we can't get near him. Because you're a human, you're the only one who's immune to its power.
But I...
Look, Arron and I have never really gotten along. And to be honest, I've never had a good opinion on humans. But I know that my brother's a good kid. If he was willing to do all of this just to get the chance to meet you, then there must be something really special about you.
You're Arron's only hope. You're our only hope.
Erica looked back at the monstrous sea sorcerer, who was cackling madly as he gazed down inside the whirlpool. She felt sick at the thought of having to get close to that thing and the pressure that now rested on her shoulders. 48 hours ago, she hadn't been aware that mermaids and mermen truly existed, and now an entire population of merfolk and every other creature of the sea were counting on her to save them from a half-man, half-octopus drunk on power. But as terrified as she was, Erica knew that she would never be able to live with herself if Arron died and she knew she could have done something to prevent it. With a deep breath, she looked at the two mermen.
Okay. Take me to the ship.
While Adonis and Avery helped Erica, the rest of the merprinces tried desperately to keep their youngest brother from dying. Atticus and Asa did their best to fight the large waves and churning water and swim in circles around Ursulus, while Arden and Apollo attempted to use their swords against his monstrous form. None of it did any good when it came to defeating him, but at the very least, if his attention was on them, then it wasn't on Arron.
You arrogant brats!
With a flash of the trident, he created a gigantic wave that swept all of the princes several miles from the confrontation. Erica watched in horror from aboard the broken ship as Adonis and Avery suddenly disappeared, leaving her completely on her own against the sorcerer. She quickly ducked down before Ursulus could spot her. Ursulus grinned down inside the whirlpool and aimed his trident at a terrified Arron. With no water for the merman to swim in, there was no way out of the deadly trap Ursulus had created. Not for the first time, Arron berated himself for falling prey to the sorcerer's charms. He had said everything that Arron had wanted to hear, not because he was interested in helping him, but because he knew that Queen Athena would readily give up her crown, her throne, and her very life in order to save her precious son. Arron should have known better than to get involved with the sorcerer, no matter how angry he had been or how desperate he was to become human. Now the entire ocean, all of the merfolk, and even Erica were going to pay for his insolence. Erica tightly gripped the steering wheel on the battered ship to try to keep her hands from trembling. She couldn't fail. If she did, she didn't even want to consider what might happen then. Erica prayed that her father had taught her enough about steering such a large ship. Unfortunately, they had never gone over how to sail through a magic whirlpool in order to defeat an evil sea sorcerer who had grown to enormous size, which meant a lot of improvisation was going to be required. The hardest part was making sure that the monster didn't see her coming beforehand. Fortunately for her, his focus was completely on Arron at the bottom of the whirlpool. Now she just had to make sure that she made it before something happened to him. Erica steered the ship through the whirlpool's fast current and headed in the direction of the sorcerer. Then, with one more quick prayer, she firmly jerked the wheel to the left. Ursulus had only 1 second to realize what was going to happen. The ship's sharp extended bow jabbed right into his abdomen and went all the way through his body. Erica slammed forward at the force of the impact, which knocked the wind out of her. Ursulus gasped and groaned in pain as he pitched forward under the ship, and his tentacles began to wrap around the whole thing to drag it down with him. As the ship's stern began to rise up further and further, Erica quickly jumped overboard and put as much distance between the ship and herself as possible so as to avoid being dragged down with it. Smoke rose up from the ocean as the magic that had made the sorcerer into a giant monster wore off, and the violent storm began to wane. Erica almost cried with relief that the merman's plan had actually worked, and she'd succeeded in ending the sorcerer's reign of terror. With all of her remaining strength, she quickly swam for the nearest shore. Now that the adrenaline had gone, she was completely spent. Once she'd reached the sand, she managed to pull herself out of the water, and then she collapsed from exhaustion. Chapter 10, Finale. With the sorcerer now dead, all of his evil magic began to undo itself. The polyps in Ursulus's lair slowly regained their true forms and gratefully swam out of the fish's skeleton. The trident and the crown floated down to the ocean floor to rest next to a lone polyp. And then the polyp swirled around and returned to being Queen Athena.
Mother!
My sons!
The princes rushed over to their mother and quickly enveloped her into a tight hug. No one cared that it wasn't proper for princes to express such outright affection for their queen. There would be times to respect propriety later.
Thank goodness you're all okay.
She looked at each of her sons' bright faces and realized that she was one short.
Where's Arron?
Avery pointed to the surface.
He's up there.
Queen Athena looked towards the rippling water above her, bright and shining with the promise of a new day and a new life. Erica slowly sat up on the sandy beach, and it took a moment for her to recall how she had ended up here for the second time in as many weeks. Then the events of the previous night came rushing back to her, and she quickly stood up and ran to the edge of the water.
Arron? Arron! Arron!
Erica?
Erica turned her head at the sound of Aaron's voice. There she saw him in the water, at the end of a rocky outcrop that started at the sand and made its way about 10 feet into the ocean. She quickly ran to the end of it, got down onto her knees, and swept Arron into a tight hug.
I'm so glad you're okay.
Aaron's hands wrapped around her back to draw her to him. Never had he been so thankful to see her alive and well. She pulled back and pressed her hand to the side of his face.
You are okay, right?
Yes, you are too.
As much as I can be.
Arron saw that she was still in her ripped wedding dress, which had now become even more tattered after last night's events. He remembered how he had previously thought that she could be wearing rags, and he would still think she was the most beautiful girl on earth. And he now saw that that statement had been very true. She gestured to his green tail.
So, this is who you really are. A merman prince.
I'm sorry our relationship started off with so much false information. But would you have even believed me if I told you that I was born with a tail and traded my voice for legs?
Probably not.
Arron noticed tears beginning to form in her eyes. And now, knowing what they were, he knew there could only be one reason for them.
What's wrong?
You know, I've always believed that I would marry whoever I fell in love with. That there was no gap too big. Even with me being a princess. But I was wrong.
Erica.
This gap is too big, Arron. I don't even know how we would try to make this work.
Arron quickly took her hands.
No, I'll find a way to be human again.
But it's not just that. Arron, you have a mother and brothers who love you very much. Your whole life is here in the ocean. I can't ask you to give all of that up for me. I don't want you to.
But...
These last few days I got to spend with you were the best of my life. After my mother and father died, I didn't think it would be possible for me to feel that happy again. I promise I'll never forget them. I'll never forget you.
She cupped his head in her hands and slowly lowered her head to kiss him. His lips were salty from the ocean, or maybe it was from her tears. She couldn't be sure. After what seemed like much too short, she pulled back a few inches. Arron reached up and lightly brushed away her tears, letting his hand linger on her cheek. Erica clutched his hand in her own for a long moment before she forced herself to stand and turn away.
Wait, Erica!
The water beside Arron began to churn and bubble, and Erica quickly turned around in alarm. It couldn't possibly be the work of the sea sorcerer, could it? But luckily, instead of Ursulus, a beautiful woman with silvery gray hair appeared, using the water to lift herself up several inches above the surface. In her hands, she held the trident, and on her head was the golden crown restored to its normal size.
Mother.
Realizing that the mermaid must be the queen of the merfolk, Erica politely curtsied.
Your Majesty.
Athena politely nodded her head.
Princess?
Erica's eyes darted over to Arron, both of them wondering how much she'd just heard. Arron, in particular, wondered just how much trouble he was in now.
Am I to understand that you're to be the ruler of this land someday?
This part of it, yes.
Then as a future ruler, it's imperative for you to know that when something is important to you, you always look for alternative solutions.
I am afraid I don't understand.
My husband was killed 18 years ago at the hands of humans. And since then, I have believed all of them to be murderous creatures who cared about no one's thoughts or feelings except their own.
Mother?
Athena held up a hand, and Arron quieted.
But you have proven me more wrong than anyone ever could.
Aaron's heart warmed at his mother's acceptance of humans after all this time of carrying grief and anger inside her.
Arron, you love this girl, correct?
Arron looked up at Erica with earnest eyes.
Very much.
And princess, do you love my son?
Erica met Aaron's love-struck gaze and smiled softly.
Yes.
Very well. Then if this is going to happen, I have some conditions. You both wait 2 years. By then, Arron will have come of age, and if I am correct about human customs, you will have too, princess.
Yes, that's correct.
That will give you both time to make sure that this is what you really want. After 2 years, if you still desire to join together, then you will have my full blessing.
Arron thought he might burst with happiness. It was one thing for his mother to finally accept humans, but it was another to accept her son's union with one.
In the meantime, if you two are going to get to know each other better, then some arrangements are going to have to be made.
She dipped the trident into the water and swirled it around in small circles as it began to glow. Water surrounded Arron and slowly lifted him up and onto the outcrop next to Erica. When the water cleared, Arron had a pair of human legs, and he was now dressed in a white shirt and light blue pants. He looked at his mother in stunned happiness.
This isn't permanent. While I now understand how much you love the human world, the ocean is still your home. So whenever your feet touch water from the sea, your tail will return. Can we all agree to this?
Yes, yes, of course.
Thank you, Your Majesty.
Arron rushed over to his mother and tightly hugged her.
Thank you.
I love you, my son. I will always love you, whether you are on land or in the sea. No matter where you are, you will always be my baby.
Just a few days ago, Arron would have been embarrassed at the admission in front of the girl he loved. But after what they'd been through last night, and not knowing if he was ever going to see her again, it was a great comfort to know that her love for him had not changed. Arron pulled back and politely bowed to his queen, to which she returned a small nod and a soft smile. Then Arron approached Erica and gently kissed her. No ultimatums, no deadlines, no pressures. Just a merman and a human girl expressing their love for one another. Arron and Erica returned to the palace hand in hand. And before they had even made it through the gates, Grimhilda ran out and swept Erica into such a tight and warm hug that for just a moment, Erica remembered what it was like to experience a mother's hug.
Oh, thank goodness you're both okay.
Then she realized what was different.
You have legs again.
And a voice.
You, my friend, have some explaining to do. Come. We'll get Chef Louise to make you two some breakfast while you tell us your story.
Wonderful. I'm starving. Saving the ocean from a power-hungry sea sorcerer can certainly whet one's appetite.
Once they had walked into the palace, Erica changed out of her tattered wedding dress and into a simple dark blue morning gown. Then they sat at the large table in the dining room while Chef Louis presented them with toast, fruits, pastries, and hotcakes. The rest of the palace staff gathered into the room, and Erica and Arron took turns explaining what had happened on the wedding boat and all of the events that had followed. After they'd finished their story, Arron was pretty sure some of the staff who hadn't been on the wedding boat still didn't believe them.
Now that we are aware of the merfolk's existence, it is now time to establish peace with them. Grimhilda, I will need your assistance in enacting some new laws to ensure their protection. Arron will help us communicate with them when need be. I expect everyone to be supportive and accepting of both him and his people.
Of course you have our full support, Your Highness. Both of you do.
After breakfast had concluded and the staff went about completing their usual chores, Arron started to head to the Chancery with Erica to begin figuring out ways to officially establish peace between humans and merfolk. A soft noise made him turn his head. Sarah slowly approached him with her head down and asked if it was true that he could speak now.
Yes, I can,
he answered, moving his hands while he spoke.
I hope that doesn't mean you're going to stop teaching me.
Sarah's brow furrowed in surprise.
I mean, isn't it a requirement here that you know the signed language? I'm still not perfect at it, and someone's going to have to keep teaching me.
Sarah smiled broadly and assured him that she would continue teaching him for as long as he desired. Over the course of the next 2 years, the entire kingdom learned about the existence of merfolk, and Erica established several new laws stating that the slaying, torturing, or hunting of mermaids and mermen was strictly forbidden and was punishable by imprisonment or death. Meanwhile, in Atlantica, Queen Athena sent a decree throughout her underwater kingdom that after the circumstances that led to the defeat of Ursulus and the return of many captured merfolk, all mermaids and mermen were now to try their best to get along with humans, especially now that her son was essentially betrothed to one. Many of the merfolk were stunned that the hard-hearted Queen Athena had changed her mind about humans so quickly, but none of them had seen what she had. None of them had watched that tiny little princess fight the sea sorcerer, despite not having fins and not being able to breathe underwater. If a human could do that all for the sake of her son, then perhaps they were not all as bad as she'd always believed. Arron established himself as a prince in Erica's kingdom, which made many of the nobles and court members more accepting of their betrothal. On several occasions, he made trips back home in order to continue working to expand merfolk-human relations with his mother and brothers. He also continued his lessons with Sarah, and ended up spending so much time with her that aside from the princess, she quickly became his closest confidant on land. Amidst their duties as royals, Arron and Erica made time to take relaxing walks along the shore. On one such occasion, Arron walked out onto one of the rocky outcroppings and jumped into the ocean. He would never admit it to anyone, especially not his mother. But while Arron adored his human legs and his life on land, he also loved the feeling of his green merman tail returning as the ocean welcomed him home. He resurfaced against the rock and held his hand out for Erica.
Come on.
Arron, I don't know if this is a good idea.
You trust me, don't you?
Erica rolled her eyes and carefully hopped off the outcrop and into the water.
Hold on to my arm, and don't let go.
Arron plunged under the water and sailed through the ocean. Erica opened her eyes, and though the salty water stung a little, it was quickly forgotten when she saw the overwhelming beauty of the creatures and plants beneath the ocean's surface. There were so many different colors and species that she had never known even existed. It was so spectacular that she couldn't help envying Arron for being able to live both on land and in the sea. Arron quickly surfaced to allow for Erica to get some air.
That was one of the most amazing things I've ever seen. Is this what it was like for you that day we went into town together?
Yes.
Suddenly, a small yellow and blue fish popped up next to them.
Hey, guys!
Arron smiled and wrapped his arms around the fish.
Erica, this is my best friend, Angel.
Pleased to meet you.
Nice to finally meet you, princess!
Call me Erica.
Wow! You're even prettier up close!
Thank you. You're very pretty yourself.
Is Arron showing you our home?
Yes, he is.
Can I come too?
Of course.
Arron smiled and took Erica's hands in his.
Then hold on.
Erica put her arms around his neck, and he once again dipped beneath the surface. Arron and Angel swam through the water at a dizzying speed, while Erica looked at all of the life below with complete fascination. She knew that she could do this forever, and the experience would never cease to amaze her. When Arron stopped again, Erica released her hold on him, floated in front of him so she could face him. and then gently kissed him. Arron pulled her close to him with one hand, while the other wound into her beautiful floating black curls. Soon enough, Aaron's brothers began making frequent trips to the surface in order to learn all they could about human life. Since all contact with humans had been forbidden for so long, they all had a lot to learn if they were going to establish peace with them. Erica was happy to spend some time each week sitting on the outcrop with her feet in the water while she answered the prince's many, many questions about how she and other humans lived. One week, Erica and Arron brought Sarah with them to the edge of the outcrop as she had previously expressed interest in meeting his family.
Guys, this is Sarah. She's my teacher and one of my best friends. Sarah, this is Adonis, Arden, Apollo, Asa, Atticus, and Avery.
Wait, what are you doing with your hands?
Sarah can't hear, so we have to communicate using a signed language. When I first came to the palace, she started teaching me and helped give me a voice when I didn't have one.
Sarah asked why everyone's name started with an A.
I guess our mother, Queen Athena, just really liked that particular letter.
The young woman smiled and signed her greetings to all of Arron's brothers.
She said it's nice to finally meet you guys, but it might take a while for her to learn all of your names because they all start with the same letter.
That's amazing. You can have a whole conversation without saying a word.
Do you think she could teach me too?
Why don't you ask her?
She can't hear me.
No, but that doesn't mean you can't talk directly to her.
Right. Sorry.
He awkwardly looked at Sarah.
Could you teach me sign language too?
Sarah looked to Arron to translate the question. When she understood, she eagerly looked back at Atticus and nodded.
She'd be happy to.
Could I learn too?
Yeah, me too!
She'd love to teach all of you if you really want to learn. So, everyone's up for it?
Yes, of course.
I don't want to learn anything from her.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Right,
this is
all right.
So
count
alone.
Me in.
I'll do it.
Arron was almost positive that Adonis was only going to learn simply because he couldn't stand the idea of his brothers, especially Arron, knowing something he didn't.
This will be great for battles. Just think, we can communicate all of our plans without any fear of the enemy overhearing.
We can say whatever we want without worrying about Mom finding out. Because she won't know what we're saying.
We are very different, Merman.
I mean, I'm not wrong.
Hey, Arron. What's the sign for thanks?
Arron demonstrated the sign for him. Apollo looked at Sarah and repeated the sign.
Thank you, m'lady, for agreeing to teach us.
Sarah smiled broadly and nodded in reply. The young woman began meeting with the princes once or twice a week in order to teach them all sign language. It was a slow process trying to teach six brothers at one time, particularly Atticus and Apollo, who seemed to have an attention span the size of plankton. Additionally, even with the language barrier, Sarah insisted that she teach them alone as she had with Arron, because it would help them learn faster. Surprising everyone, including the involved parties, Sarah ended up getting along best with Adonis. Arron thought for sure that he would see fish fly and birds swim before Adonis got along with a human. But out of all of his brothers, Adonis kept coming back more and more often to meet with Sarah. He never missed a single lesson, and before long, he eventually started meeting with her by himself. It started off as a way to learn more, and Arron was fairly certain Adonis just wanted to get ahead of everyone else. But the more he met with her, it became less of a lesson time and more of a casual meeting where they simply talked and enjoyed each other's company. As temperamental as Adonis was, Sarah's warm personality and eagerness to teach him seemed to simmer much of his hot-headed nature, and she helped him really understand that some humans weren't that bad. Finally, 2 years passed, and the day Arron had been so long awaiting had arrived. The day of the wedding. According to merman traditions, he was finally of age, and he had his mother's blessing upon his desire to marry Erica. He knew she had made him wait so that he could be sure that he really wanted to live on land with the humans, and he understood and respected that decision. But all that the 2 years had done was further his deep love for Erica. He simply could not imagine living his life without her. Carlyle made the final adjustments to his formal suit and stood back to admire his work.
You look perfect. Are you ready?
I think so. I still don't really know how human weddings usually go.
Well, fortunately for you, due to the rather unusual upbringing of the groom, this wedding isn't going to be like a normal human one.
How so?
We hold weddings inside the chapel, not on the beach. But the princess insisted we do it this way, so that your family would be able to attend.
If you ask me, having weddings on a beach should become a new tradition.
Come along now. It's time for the ceremony to begin.
Down along the shoreline, the palace staff had set up a small but elegant altar and aisle for the bride and groom. Various nobles from surrounding kingdoms, members of the court, and some of the townsfolk filled the chairs on either side of the aisle, some of them grumbling about the improper nature of the ceremony. Out in the ocean, mermaids and mermen from Atlantica, in addition to Angel and Serena, surfaced in order to watch the marriage of their youngest prince. Even Scuttle flew overhead, silent for once, but still excited for her friend. Then Queen Athena conjured a small wave of water to lift herself up a few inches above the ocean, her trident gleaming in her hand and proving that she was indeed Queen of the Merfolk. Following Queen Athena's appearance, all of Arron's brothers surfaced behind her by order of their age. Arron couldn't help wondering what was going through his brothers' minds. Were they upset that the youngest one was getting married first? Happy? Jealous? Proud? But then Arron suddenly couldn't remember what he had just been thinking about. Because at that moment, Erica stepped onto the beach, assisted by Grimhilda and Sarah, and she looked so stunningly beautiful that it didn't seem to make any sense why she was here marrying him. Her white laced wedding dress looked infinitely better than the one Ursulus's Varian had forced her to wear. It fit her perfectly in all the right places and exquisitely complemented her black hair, which hung in loose curls underneath a long tulle veil. She smiled broadly as she met his eyes, and he didn't think that he'd ever seen her look so happy. If he had had any doubts before, they would have vanished into thin air, never to be seen again. Arron and Erica stepped to the back of the aisle and faced one another. Arron bowed low at the waist, and Erica curtsied deeply. Then she took his arm, and they both slowly made their way down the makeshift aisle. Once at the altar, the priest greeted the attendees, including the merfolk, then had the bride and groom recite their vows to each other and present each other with their wedding rings. After the vows and rings had been exchanged, Arron gently cupped Erica's face in his hands and deeply kissed her, officially making them husband and wife. The entire crowd, nobles, servants, and merfolk, cheered for the newly wedded couple. Instead of walking back down the aisle, Arron and Erica walked towards the water. Sarah assisted Erica with her long dress as she walked, and it was only by chance that Arron witnessed a blush cross her face when she looked in Adonis's direction. He glanced towards his eldest brother and, wait just a minute, were Adonis's cheeks reddening? Arron lightly nudged Erica's arm and discreetly nodded towards Adonis while his eyes moved in Sarah's direction. Erica glanced at Aaron's oldest brother and her servant next to her. Then she looked at Arron with her eyebrows raised as if to ask, Sarah and Adonis? Really?
Arron shrugged his shoulders. He made a mental note to ask his brother about that later.
Queen Athena smiled at her son with tears in her eyes. She used her trident to pull part of the shoreline back so Arron could come to her without transforming. Athena put her hand to her son's face.
I am so proud of you, Arron.
Arron smiled at her. How he had so longed to hear those words from her. The queen held her hand out towards the princess, and Erica slowly stepped forward. Once in front of the merfolk queen, she dipped into a polite curtsy. Queen Athena held up a necklace with a small turquoise shell.
My husband, King Triton, made this at the same time he made Arron's. He intended it for the one his youngest son married. And it is my honor to present it to you now.
Erica turned around to allow the queen to clasp the necklace around her neck. She then smiled at the queen.
Thank you so much.
Athena kissed the princess on the forehead and then lightly held her hand under the young woman's chin.
Welcome to our family, Princess Erica.
End of story.